Good morning and welcome to the second meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Scottish Budget 24-25 from two panels of witnesses. First, we hear from the Scottish Parliament corporate body on its own budget bid before taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance. And I move to our first panel of witnesses, Jackson Carlow, MSP, member of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. Who is joined today by Scottish Parliament officials David McGill, Clerk, Chief Executive, and Sarah Glass, Group Head of Financial Governance at Scottish Parliament. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting this morning. I intend to allow an hour for this session, and I invite Mr Carlow to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and it's a pleasure to be with you again. And I'd like to take a brief opportunity to set the context for the Scottish Parliament Corporate Body's 24-25 budget bid and set out some key points. This is the third of our medium-term financial plan for Session 6 and is aligned with the commitments made in 22-23 submission, which focused on setting up Scottish parliamentary services for the challenges of Session 6. As with the 23-24 bid, the key challenges we face in the 24-25 bid centre around inflationary pressures and establishing a budget which is fair and affordable and takes account of continued high inflation. In summary, the total proposed budget for 24-25 is £126.5 million, and that represents an £8.9 million, or a 7.6% increase on the current financial year's budget, and is £6 million, or 5% increase on the indicative 24-25 budget, which was previously advised to the Finance and Public Administration Committee last year. Now, this overall increase of 7.6% is primarily driven by inflation, by electricity prices at rates well above inflation, and increases in officeholder costs due to anticipated inflationary staff costs. And unlike the 23-24 budget, when we were able to partially offset the inflationary impacts with just a 4.5% increase at a time of double-digit price inflation, with more than 70% of our cost base being staffing, Scottish Parliamentary Services, MSPs, MSP staff and office holders, which you recall has been the subject to recent reviews, there really are no additional material efficiency opportunities available for the 24-25 budget that wouldn't compromise our operational abilities, particularly the operational abilities of MSPs, to hold the government to account. But we are about to consider whether we need to adopt any services contracts at Holyrood in light of changes of footfall and usage post-pandemic to ensure we are operating efficiently, and this will be considered a high level by the SPCB during the course of this year. For MSPs and ministerial salaries, I confirm that since we broke the pay link with Westminster in 2015, we've consistently used ASH as our index as set out in the scheme. Last year, that resulted in an increase of 1.5%. Which was substantially lower than general inflation and all other wage inflation indices applied here in the Parliament and elsewhere. The scheme allows the corporate body to use the ASH index or such other index as the SPCB may from time to time consider or deem appropriate. This year, we intend to apply the average weekly earnings index at 6.7%, as it would appear to us that the ASH index has become misaligned with other wage inflation indices over the last few years, for reasons we can't properly understand and are ourselves investigating, so we may return to it. However, this means that an MSP salary of £72,195 in 24-25, prior to breaking linking MSP salaries with Westminster, MSP salaries equated to 87.5% of an MP salary. As of 23-24, they equate to 78.1%. And worth noting that IPSA, the independent body that recommends salary increases at Westminster, have recommended an increase of 7.1% for MPs in 24-25. Following the last triennial review of the Members' Pension Scheme, Government Actuaries Department, the GAD, recommended an increase in the sponsor contributions to the scheme, and the corporate body accepted this advice, and this is reflected in the 24-25 members' budget. Turning to staff cost provision, for last year's budget, 23-24, the corporate body chose to use the AWE, the average weekly earnings, to uplift the staff cost provision in a move away from the basket approach of indexing staff cost provision annually using a mix of AWE and the ASH index to which I referred a moment ago and which appears to be kind of slightly out of alignment. This had been adopted since 21-22. General inflation was 10%, the basket was 4.1%, and the AWE was 5.6% at the time. In selecting the 24-25 uprating index, the corporate bodies expressed a preference to continue with the AWE for one further year and to avoid the greater volatility reflected by the ASH index during this continued period of inflationary volatility. And therefore, applying the AWE for staff cost provision is consistent with the index selected for members' pay at a rate of 6.7%. This would mean a rate of £156,900 per member. And the budget submission includes this assumption. SPS staff budget maintains the staffing baseline as agreed in the 22-23, with the 24-25 budget uprated to take account of anticipated inflationary wage pressures. We've also reflected revised increased My Civil Service pension contribution rates within our costs for 24-25. Following a prioritisation exercise, the total amount incorporated in the 24-25 budget for revenue and capital projects is £5.3 million, which is a marginal inflationary increase in 23-24. And in our submission, we highlight a number of major projects in Schedule 3, which are underway or due to commence in 24-25, such as the ongoing building energy management system, which is driven partly by green issues and also obsolescence issues, or BEMS, which I referred to last year. The corporate systems programme encompassing the business critical applications for finance, people services and payroll, which as well as being fundamental, the systems are also organisation-wide. Official report digital transformation, which is the replacement of the system used to produce the official report and aims to address technical obsolescence, improve edit production and publishing processes, and deliver efficiencies in the operation and maintenance of the IT system. Business bulletin replacement with the aim of delivering a new streamlined business bulletin production process and supporting application. And Windows 10 replacement with support for our current Windows 10 operating system ending in October next year. The office holders 24-25 budget submissions total £18.3 million, which is £1.7 million, or 10% higher than the current year. As the committee knows, the corporate body carefully scrutinises the office holder budget bids and challenge if no clear justification for increase has been given. Above inflation increases in 24-25 are driven by anticipated staff costs across all the office holders and additional functions added to the remit of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. We continue to include a contingency provision, but we've reduced this year back to the 22-23 level of £1 million to reflect widespread expectation of reduced inflationary volatility during the course of the budget year, which was the reason we built the extra contingency in last year. So that concludes my remarks. Some of it's obviously quite technical, some of it is for the record, but I thank you for your patience.
Yes, thank you very much. I'll try to keep my questions fairly short and not too long, given the fact we've only about an hour and other members will wish, no doubt, to come in. I mean, you talked about, and it's in your submission, about having a submission that's fair and affordable. Do you think it's fair and affordable for the Scottish Parliament's budget to go up by 7.6% when the Scottish Government's budget for everything that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament is responsible for is only going up by 2.6% in resource over the next financial year?
I think as we've identified, a significant 80% of our budget is actually driven by the staff costs that operate within the Parliament. We took critical decisions in the last Parliament, driven by the requests of this committee and by MSPs, to increase the resource that was made available to MSPs to run their offices and to the overall structure of the Parliament, because we felt, and committees felt, it was important that the resource existed to allow them to hold the government to account. If we were to take account of these other matters, and we obviously apply as rigid a discipline as we can, but the principle we've operated from is that it is this Parliament's responsibility and the corporate body's responsibility to ensure that this Parliament can operate to maximum capacity in its ability to support members and to hold the Scottish Government to account. I think the only way that it would be open to us to do anything differently would be to compromise that ability, and the corporate body is not prepared to submit a budget that would do that.
Okay, since we're going to have a session probably lasting in excess of 2 hours with the Deputy First Minister, which lots of other areas of Scottish Government responsibility are going to have to do just that, and it just seems the Scottish corporate body is somewhat out of kilter in terms of that. I mean, when we look at actual staff pay budget of 7.7%, what's the differential between kind of basic pay going up and grade inflation, as you might call it? You know, people, you know, we've got the same number of staff. I understand there's not going to be any additions to staff. The kind of staff increase in numbers that we had last year has been consolidated. So where are we in terms of that?
So, to take that question, we have looked across the staff profile. There's no evidence of any grade inflation at all. We looked at the job evaluation factors that decide what grades sit where in the organisation, and that was independently assessed in the last few years, and we were given a clean bill of health in that one. And actually the profile we have from 2018 has barely changed. If anything, there's been a very minor reduction in the proportion of jobs that are at the very senior level. So we don't have any evidence of grade inflation. And I think that reflects the fact that the corporate body's approach has always been one of fairness and equity, ensuring that salaries are proportionate for the jobs that we have. And again, I think this is evidenced by the fact that over 90% of our jobs are filled at any one time. We have low turnover rates. We've managed to eliminate the gender pay gap this year as well. So all of the evidence is that the pay structure that the corporate body has as a strategy means that the pressures that can lead in other organisations to grade inflation don't exist in the Scottish Parliament pay scales.
Okay, in terms of the allocation that MSPs are given in order to employ their own staff, that's going to go up to £156,900 per member. What kind of utilisation do we have of that? So where are we at in terms of the average for both list and constituency members in terms of how much that budget's being used?
In terms of the utilisation, you'll remember this time last year when setting the budget, we increased the vacancy gap, as it were. So we previously had an uptake of 95% and we reduced that to 93%. So that we've kept that same utilisation rate for this current year's budget. In the current year, with this is the first time of being at that lower rate, we're very close to that being maximised across the total. We're not anticipating having much underspend at the end of this financial year for staff cost provision.
Is that for MSP staff cost provision?
Yeah.
Right, that's fair. I suppose that's fair enough then. I was going to ask you, one of the things you've just talked about is the you're going to consider whether or not you need to adapt any service contracts at Holyrood in light of changes to footfall and usage post-pandemic to ensure operating efficiency. Why is it taking so long to do that? It seems to be quite a long process. I'd have thought that would have been implemented long before now.
Well, I don't think there is ever a year zero in terms of us examining and looking at these issues. It's an ongoing process, but very often the changes that we've made lead to consequential opportunities. But David, would you like to expand?
Yeah, it's very much that case. This is the next phase, if you like. So we've spent the previous couple of years since we started to come back into the building, looking at the ways that the building can be used and responding to the demands for increased flexibility by members, member staff and parliamentary staff. So you see round about the organisation, we've created touchdown desk spaces, bookable desk spaces, collaboration areas. I think pre-pandemic we had something like 4 offices in the building which could be used for hybrid working. We've increased that to 60 over the last 2 years. We've also created areas that are quiet spaces for people to work, principally the hub area on just off the garden lobby. So that's what we've spent the last 2 years doing. That's where the focus has been. We're now turning to looking at the information that we have gathered in that time about footfall and the the building about what can then be done, and some of these might require changes to contracts. So at this stage, we would need to wait until those contracts expired anyway. So it's not the case that we haven't been doing anything. We've been building the evidence base that we would need to make changes to contract renewal when that comes up.
Costs have gone up by 13% to just over £9.8 million. What's the reason for that?
Sorry, which
property
cost?
Costs.
Property cost. David?
Yes, so there's a number of key cost categories within the property costs, the most material being rates, maintenance, utilities and cleaning. And of those, rates, utilities and cleaning are all increasing at rates ahead of inflation. There's a number of drivers for that. Utilities is the biggest increase, and within that it's electricity, and for electricity it's electricity pricing, it's not usage. Our electricity is purchased through Scottish Government contracts, and they endeavour to have significant pre-bought ahead of the year. When we put the budget together this time last year, we understood that is normally the case, there would be about 80% pre-bought, but in reality that turned out not to be the case. We only had 60% pre-bought, but because of the whole of the prior year had been fully bought at prices from pre-Ukraine war, what we saw on the 1st of April this year is that pricing went from, I think, 12 pence per kilowatt hour to 23 per kilowatt hour, so it almost doubled. So for the element that wasn't pre-bought, we then had that full pricing exposure. So the impact, whilst we're showing it for next year's budget, a significant amount has been realised in this current financial year. That's been covered by contingencies. So the assumed rate increase for next year is actually quite minimal, but the bulk of the issue has been in this current financial year. So that's a big part of the increase. Similar issue in terms of cleaning. The current year costs are ahead of what we'd assumed in the budget, and that's really the big increase in terms of from budget to budget. It's not we missed the inflationary increase in this current year's budget, so we have that catch up for next year. And rates is the other area where we've got a material increase as well. Again, that crystallised during the year. The district valuer reassessed the rateable value of the Holyrood campus during the year. That wasn't something that we could have anticipated what that would have turned out at. And that's driven an extra about £170,000 of cost into the current year, which of course then rolls forward. We have assumed a relatively modest increase in the rates for the upcoming year, but that's under inflation levels. It's really the issue that crystallised in the current year. So those are the three key factors that are taking us. But obviously electricity pricing is the really big headline in here.
Okay, I'm only going to touch on two further points. One is IT. I look at IT and alarm bills do ring, given the £3 million that, in my view, was squandered on a not particularly great alleged improvement in a website, which we, of course, have discussed at some length in previous years. And I see that improving the bulletin is going to cost some £300,000 to £500,000, which seems to me a rather high amount of money, an excessive amount of money. And also, that's the official report, it's going to be £300,000 to £500,000. The business bulletin, £245,000 to £370,000. I'm struggling to understand where the demand is for those changes and why it's going to cost so much. Ironically, the Windows 10 replacement of 1,600 devices seems to be costing £143,396,000. That looks almost a modest figure, you know, when you think of the work involved. So I'm just trying to get my head around why, and I wonder if you can explain why the changes to the official report and the business bulletin are so expensive.
Convener, as somebody who is IT blind, I share your astonishment at all these matters, but the corporate body who are, I might uncharitably say, are like-minded to myself in these matters. These are matters to which we ourselves obviously expect some comprehensive understanding and briefing. But Sarah.
On the official report, so these are estimates at the moment. The business case is that at a strategic level has been approved, and the team are going out to tender. So that I guess the figures could different. The range is the current estimate. There's a proportion of that more than 100,000, which is the backfill, the staffing, so we can release staff to work on it. You know, our staffing levels are such that we don't we don't resource to a level that would support that.
£1,000 of staff time to upgrade the official report or the bulletin. I mean, you know, I actually understand why these tasks are necessary, frankly. But I mean, to me, 100,000 as if it's just nothing. I mean, that's a lot of money to work on something like upgrading a business bulletin. You know, I mean, it's
that figures for the official report. And essentially, that's the time that the staff need, both in the design phase and the early preparation stage, the testing, and then in the implementation, in order to build. I guess in the past, perhaps, where projects have not been as successful and delivered the change and the benefits that we would have expected, is because we haven't fully resourced it. We've assumed that people can do it on top of their...
The £3 million spent on the website wasn't enough to actually deliver a quality website. Is that what you're trying to say?
I didn't specifically reference the web. Any strategic change in the past, I could fall into that category. I guess the one thing to say, which when the previous editor, the official report system, was implemented in 2010, that cost £475,000. So in today's money, that would be more than £700,000. So the estimate for this particular piece of work is lower than that. Clearly, you know, the business case has come to the Strategic Resources Board, and the projects and programmes are also shared with corporate body, and so they are heavily scrutinised in the process of being approved. So, for some assurance that we do challenge the figures and make sure that that the assumptions are robust, but equally that on an ongoing basis that the budgets allocated are closely monitored and challenged.
Still not sure why they're obsolete, you know. What is it that they don't deliver that they need to deliver? The bulletin.
As I understand of the bulletin, it's extremely complex to produce and involves lots of data and lots of information from lots of different parts of the organisation, and it's cumbersome and possibly not as user-friendly as it could be.
I can assure you, Convener, we did have a presentation on this which was extremely persuasive, and I'm sure we can facilitate your engagement with that presentation if that would be helpful. Can I say, because since we are a couple of old-school stalwarts, the official report is now sent to everybody, all members, at the start of each day. That was at my request, because it is my underlying prejudice that when it was a physically produced official report in hard copy on paper, that it would regularly be the case that members in the chamber would pick up a copy and could be seen perusing the wider discourse of parliamentary debate. And I do wonder the extent to which members, now that it is only available digitally, spend any time looking at the official report to see what has been discussed in Parliament beyond their own involvement in a particular debate. And so I do think, when to come back to the original, but is the official report an important document? I think it is, but actually I think the corporate body are continuing to think of ways in which we can ensure there's a wider engagement with the official report by members, because it is a valuable source of updating members on the wider portfolio of issues that are being discussed in Parliament.
I absolutely, completely agree with that. I remember when Jim Eadie was next to me, he had like a mountain of every official report, you know, that had been since he'd been elected. So I do think it is an invaluable resource, and I commend you for actually ensuring that we do get it every day. I know that when the new website came in, that we were still able to access it on the old website. I think it's very important. It's also important to cross-check what people said in previous debates. So I'm just not sure why it needs to be updated. But we'll move on, because the last thing I want to talk about is inevitably the issue with regard to office holders. And the reason for that is, although you've talked about a 10% increase, which is very significant, again, when we look at where other areas of the Scottish budget are under severe pressure, but when you actually look at the eight office holders, I looked at them in some detail, because the 10% hides a multitude of sins. So, for example, if you look at staffing costs, the Scottish Public Sector Ombudsman up 12.8%, Scottish Information Commissioner 9.8%, Commissioner for Children and Young People in Scotland 17.5%, Scottish Human Rights Commission 11%, and Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland 14.2%. I remember they had a big jump last year as well. And Standards Commissioner for Scotland 13.2%, Biometrics 16.3%, Electoral Commission is only 4%. You did mention earlier on, Jackson, you know, the careful scrutiny that the SPCB has on this. And you also mentioned that, for example, the Ombudsman is increasing functions. But the Ombudsman's staff budget is now over £6 million, which is equivalent of the staff budget of 40 MSPs. I'm not actually convinced that the Public Sector Ombudsman's office does the work of 40 MSP offices. I mean, I'd be shocked if it did, given the amount of work that goes into my office, and I'm sure in many others. So I'm just wondering, how can these colossal increases in salary for all but the Electoral Commission be justified at this difficult time?
Thank you for that trenchantly put sequence of observations. I think the first thing to say, and I'll come to David in a moment, but I think the first thing to say is percentage increases can look quite sensational in relation to some relatively small budgets. The vast majority of the cost of the office holders, and as you know, the corporate body have discussed with you, and we are grateful for the inquiry that you now have underway, the overall expansion and principal understanding of what office holders are doing. The corporate body's responsibility, though, is not to editorialise, but to enact the will of Parliament, which is why our responsibility is Parliament having decided the office holders shall exist, that they are able to undertake and dispose of their functions effectively. Now, some of them have had additional responsibilities applied to them. Some of them have made budget submissions, which Hugh and Janice, who operate with the office holders on a daily basis, have interrogated, and which the corporate body have declined to accept. So it's not the case that the budget that you are seeing before you is one which has not been scrutinised, analysed, interrogated, and in some cases declined. But some of these office holders are still relatively low in overall costs, so that when you apply a percentage, it can look quite significant, but it could in fact just be one additional employee or partial employee who has been added to it. But I will allow David to expand.
Yeah, I mean, this is an area of concern, and the corporate body is concerned about the growing proportion of its overall budget that is consumed by office holders, and they're very very engaged with the work that the committee has announced that it's going to undertake. I think in terms of the staffing costs, looking across the piece, I think in his opening remarks, Jackson Callow talked about how the Parliament's budget has 70% of it as staffing. That goes out to 80% when you look at the office holders. So their flexibility in terms of non-staffing costs is much reduced.
Number of staff. I mean, if you're increasing a staff budget, if every other cost is fixed and you increase the staff budget, as the Scottish Ombudsman has done, you know, by £700,000, then it's going to actually increase the percentage of their budget that goes in staff.
Well, this year, if you look across the piece, there is only a proposal for one extra member of staff across all of the office holders, and that is almost entirely funded from within existing budgets. The cost pressures this year have come from the inflationary increases that we've talked about. There's been a recent change in pensions legislation, which has added another £100,000 to the staffing budget. Lots of the staff, we talked last year about the Ethical Standards Commissioner employing more staff. Those staff are moving through progressions. Commissioners are entitled to pay progressions as well. So those add over and above just salary increases, and I think that's been a feature of these budgets. The point.
Sorry, last year the Ethical Standards Commissioner got an additional, let's see if I can remember, 7.4 members of staff, this is from memory, and an average salary of £57,700, and it's gone up 14.2%. So all these folk who just started last year are all getting promoted, are they?
They would have started at the bottom of the scale. Those costs would not all be salary costs. They would include pension costs and employers' national insurance costs as well, so it's not all about salary. The point you made about the Ombudsman as well, I would say that those office holders that are responsible for investigations and complaints, they are required to go through a statutory process, so the comparison with MSP officers might not be quite the same. And in some cases, we know that MSPs do signpost constituents to the office holders. The Ombudsman is also, as well as being the Ombudsman, is the National Whistleblower Officer for the NHS, and she also oversees the Welfare Fund. So there are a variety of functions in there that go beyond just the investigation of complaints.
Yeah, it sticks out because we're looking at all the other areas of the Scottish budget has to fund. We have a 2.6% increase in resource, and this just looked way out of kilter. I mean, I'm sure you must see that now. You said earlier on that there are some people you've said niet to in terms of this. Who have you basically said, no, hold on, we don't actually think that salary or budget increase is justified?
I think we mentioned last year that we'd done that with the Scottish Human Rights Commission. They had a bid for a significant increase of staff. Well, there have been no staff bids that we've rejected this year, no increases in proposals for increasing the staff base.
But we have interrogated requests for additional monies to fund particular projects, some of which we've asked to be deferred or to be looked at again.
Okay. I won't continue because colleagues are keen to come in. And the first one to come in will be Liz, to be followed by John.
Thank you. Mr Carlow, you made a very interesting remark in response to the convener earlier when you said that as the SPCB sets its budget, one of the underlying principles is that this budget has to ensure that this Parliament is holding the government to account and that it is proper on scrutiny. In relation to the question about the office holders and the commissioners, moving forward, do you think that is the appropriate principle by which we judge whether we have a sufficient number, the correct number, of office holders and commissioners? Or do you think there are other underlying principles that we should be looking at?
There's a temptation to answer this on a personal basis, and there's a temptation to answer this on behalf of the corporate body. I mean, I return to the point that the corporate body's responsibility is to enact the will of Parliament. The presiding officer has obviously, it's a matter of public record, raised with the Scottish Government the issue of office holders. Last year, I made a particular point of raising it here with this committee, because as a corporate body, and as a long-standing member of the Scottish Parliament myself, who was on in my first session in 2007-11, a committee whose responsibility, charged by Parliament, was to rationalise the number of office holders we had at that time, for which there was an unabated enthusiasm amongst members in the Parliament, I'm struck in this session of Parliament and I think my colleagues in the corporate body watching this unfold are struck by the attraction to colleagues of embracing campaigns that will lead to the creation of additional commissioners, which has almost become now a de facto go-to. And the reason we raised it last year in particular is because I think we feel or can see, respecting still the will of the Parliament, that the areas that we are beginning to generate commissioners for, if accepted by Parliament, would make it harder for Parliament to justify not creating commissioners in other areas where one could say there was a similarity either in the responsibility or the function, and that you could see an exponential growth of commissioners. There is a question of democratic accountability, in my view, as to why as a parliament we were set up in the first place, and are we devolving from ourselves to others responsibility for matters. And just my working knowledge as an individual in whatever walk of life I've been, that when institutions of this character are created, they invariably grow, both in terms of remit and in terms of size. And that appears to be the example. And part of that is, as the public become more aware, more inquiries are made of, and therefore the responsibility grows. Or, as is also the case with initiatives currently being progressed by members of Parliament, you know, maybe in relation to things like freedom of information, we could, as a Parliament, take decisions which will significantly grow the responsibility of the commissioner to whom that responsibility has been devolved. So I think there's a big question for MSPs in all of this as we look to the future. And you will see in the indicative budget for next year, with the addition of the patient safety commissioner who was approved by Parliament just in the last couple of months or so, the increase in the office holder provision in the indicative budget for next year is significantly ahead of the inflationary increase that we are expecting to apply to the rest of the Parliament. So incrementally, the overall cost of office holders as part of our overall parliamentary budget is increasing. So there's a financial aspect and there is an accountability aspect. Sorry, that was quite a long answer, but I hope that was helpful.
It's a very helpful answer, if I may say so, and I think it ties in largely with a lot of the feelings of this particular committee. Obviously, the SPCB has a limited role. It's, as you rightly say, it to put in the will of Parliament. It's not for you to make decisions about what should happen. But when we've taken evidence from civil servants, Scottish Government officials, there seems to be a bit of a lack of clarity about who should make the decision over how many commissioners we might have and in what respect they would be held accountable to the SPCB. I think there's a bit of lack of clarity. That's not the SPCB's fault. But I think as we look at this issue, I think there are two things we have to pick up. Firstly, to ensure that whatever structure we come out with enhances the scrutiny of this Parliament. But secondly, that we are very clear about the process of decision-making as to how many commissioners we have. And I'm just seeking your agreement that these are the two main issues that the SPCB will consider as you obviously have to put another budget in train this time next year.
I think you identify the two key issues. I think that the latter one is the one that I wrestle with, because it's not clear to me that there is any overarching body who is looking holistically at the office holder landscape. The corporate body's responsibility is to enact the will of Parliament. The Scottish Government can propose the establishment of commissioners. The members of Parliament can propose through private members' bills the establishment of commissioners. In my experience, every one of these proposals has been considered in isolation in relation to the actual proposal before Parliament, but never in terms of an overall landscape. In the most recent debate, personally, but on behalf of the corporate body, I tried to introduce that into the discussion on the patients' rights commissioners. But it becomes very difficult when you are in a debate progressing legislation in respect of a particular commissioner, when everything is in that debate is about the merits of the position in question, to really have a wider discussion about what it is that Parliament is in the round doing or seeking to do, or even prioritising. Because even if you were to argue, I think, that there is an argument for commissioners, we are considering these not in any structured way, but on the basis of who's proposing what at any given moment in time.
So do you think it is a unanimous view of the SPCB that we do need more clarity on this whole issue and therefore greater accountability.
Yes, it would be fair to say that is the view of the corporate body, and I think further it would be fair to say that we would be of the view that this is something that this session of Parliament should try to wrestle with and resolve, because the difficulty could be that a new cohort of MSPs might accept the landscape as they find it and simply seek to expand it further without these considerations and longer-term perspectives being reflected.
The increasing costs that go along with it.
Indeed.
Thank you, Convener.
John, to follow by Michelle.
Thanks very much. I think I'll leave the commissioners. I think we've had a good airing and we're looking forward to the inquiry we're having. I mean, probably then to follow up some of the points that the convener raised. I mean, I have to say, I think the using the AWE is a reasonable way forward, both for MSPs and MSP staff. I think I was working out for the four-year average for the MSP increase, it's 2.9% for the last 4 years, which I think is pretty easy to sell or reasonable, because the public obviously don't want us to have any increase, or some of them don't. I think you said you were going to do more work on the ASH figures and why they are, and the word volatility was used. So do you have any clarity as to why they're volatile or more volatile than other measures?
No. I think we are looking into that. I mean, for as long as we went through a sustained period of very low inflation, which is frankly what we have done until the most recent issues became prevalent, this didn't seem to be something that mattered. And I would say that we may well return to the ASH index. I mean, we didn't move away from it lightly. But I think, convener, when I came to you last year with the ASH index recommending an increase of 1.5%, I did say at that point we weren't trying to be virtue signalling. It was that we believed there was a lagging factor in the ASH index, which would be reflected this year. And so we were surprised to find that that didn't happen. And we don't know why it didn't happen. And it is obviously a matter that we want to investigate. It has an impact both on the salary increase of MSPs, but also on the staff cost provision as well. And so we think the average weekly earnings index is a more reliable one for us to look at, to use while we investigate that issue. But you are right, over a period of time, it is as you suggest. There was a year when we did not take the ASH increase of 5.1%, but took nothing because we reflected the stresses and strains of the pandemic at that in that particular year.
Okay, thank you. Some of the projects that are coming up, and you mentioned already some of the hybrid working more, and so you've got more spaces that people can work in. So I was going to ask you how successful the hub has been, because I do pass it. We all pass it regularly. It doesn't appear to be very busy, but maybe it is well used. And then kind of linked to that, there's a heading, office space planning and moves, £200,000. I just wonder what that's for.
I'll let David start, and I think he may then.
In relation to the success of the hub, the information I have is it has been very successful, and it's perhaps been a bit surprisingly successful in relation to MSP staff. I understand that where accommodation can be quite constrained in the MSP block, that lots of MSP staff have chosen to use it. And I would stress that it's available to all pass holders. It's not just available to parliamentary staff. On the other question that you had, I think I'll pass over to Sarah, who might be able to answer that better than I can.
Yeah, I've got a breakdown of the 200,000 in terms of what that's allocated to. So there's a review of the upper basement that's planned. There's work in the MSP block to provide phone booths for privacy calls, Teams meetings for members' staff. There's signage, new signage blocks on all the MSP block and ministerial tower to simplify changing of text. UB24, they're going to convert that room into an additional rest area for security. They don't have anywhere at the moment, as I understand. There's some office reconfiguration, consolidation in one of the areas. Similarly, there's consolidation of office space to create capacity in another area. And there's a sort of unallocated at the moment balance.
For it, that's fine. I mean, I'm interested that so there appears to be a problem with the open plan aspect of the MSP staff, that they can all hear each other when they're having discussions. So that's a downside of open plan system.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I guess the hub is used sometimes for that purpose as well, to try and, you know, some of the spaces are a little bit more private. But yeah, to do more in the MSP block is in the plan for the 200,000.
Into that in any more detail. Another one was net zero scrutiny, £415,000. I thought we're doing net zero anyway. It says other projects, including embedding sustainable development thinking and support to members' committees on net zero. Is it more aimed at the committees?
The net zero funding in the current year includes the BEMS spend. I don't think that number that you're describing will be. I mean, we are doing work on improving the scrutiny from a sustainable development perspective, but I would be surprised if the value was as significant as that.
Slightly at a C with the question, but we could take this away and look at it and come back to you if that would be helpful.
I wasn't pulling it off your papers directly. It's actually, I think, a bigger page. Well, it's on our page 17, but I don't know where that comes in yours, but it's under projects to be funded in 24-25 budget, and the final one is other, 415,000. Part of which probably is embedding sustainable development.
Yeah, there are several projects within there, of which the embedding sustainable development is one of them. But there's at least five or six in there.
Right. Okay. Thank you. I mean, I take your point that MSPs are taking up about 93% of their staffing allocation. I mean, is this just wishful thinking, or is there any way, by encouraging MSPs to keep their spending down, you know, voluntarily, even though they are allowed to spend up to the limit? Because we have this problem, and it's a problem in the public sector, that you've got a budget for X, and therefore there's this feeling that you have to spend X. And, you know, we see that in many areas, and I've heard colleagues discussing this, that I must spend my, I've got this budget, I must spend this full budget. And I just wonder if there's any space for encouraging MSPs to save money, because if they save money, that's going to help someone else.
We certainly don't have a window sticker that says you must spend your budget. it's obviously open to members to determine that. I think that the uptake very often, Mr. Mason, is because of in-year changes that staff can leave, and it can then take quite a period of time for them to be replaced. And all of that can have, you know, it can, in my own office, for example, you know, a highly paid member of staff left unexpectedly. There's a period of time where I'm reassessing whether or not I want to replace that individual in quite the same way. And that therefore means that in this particular year, my own utilisation of the staff provision will be less than it's been in other years. And I think that kind of reality applies across most parliamentary offices, which leads to the fact that it's unlikely that you would ever have a year in which there would be a 100% utilisation of the overall budget. And that 93% is kind of where we've worked out, looking at experience over years, particularly mid-years of the Parliament, because obviously in the first year of the Parliament it's usually less than that, because you have a lot of new members who don't have staff at all who are in the business of recruiting them. But as you go through the mid-years of the Parliament, that seems to be a relatively reasonable way pitch at the level that is required.
Okay, I'll not pursue that one. I mean, I assume you're looking always at ways of perhaps saving money and doing things more efficiently and all that kind of thing. Efficiency has been mentioned already. I mean, for example, I don't know how often the MSP's offices are cleaned, but I get the impression it's every day. Someone goes in every night to all the offices. Now, I don't think that's necessary. I mean, my office, I think, is fairly tidy, and people don't tidy it anyway, they just clean. But, you know, appears on my desk is rearranged every night. And I just wonder if something like that could be reduced to once a week or something.
Well, let me take that away and see what the arrangement is there. As it happens, I think whoever's in charge of cleaning swung by my office this morning to ask if I was completely satisfied with the cleaning, to which I said that I was. But I take your point. It's not a case of tidying some offices. I think that would be beyond the ability of anyone, having visited some colleagues' offices.
OK, and the final question I just had was about the shop. It's not been mentioned so far. It was just a thought that came to me that, I mean, there's a bit of a challenge that people might want to buy something from the shop, but they have to come through the whole security system to get there. Members of the public, I'm thinking. Have you thought about some of these products being available in another shop in the Royal Mile, say, on a kind of franchise basis, so we could boost sales and maybe make a bit more profit in the shop?
I mean, can you illustrate that with perhaps a product you have in mind?
Well, I mean, there's lots of things that are attractive, like the chocolate in the Parliament, a wrapping, the scarves and the ties in Parliament, which presumably are not available anywhere else, I assume, unless it's online.
There were six sales.
Is that right?
Literally. I think it is an interesting concept. The question really is, how attractive are these things to the wider public? And it was something of a surprise, I think, to me when I was looking at this, to see how little purchasing there is online of Scottish Parliamentary branded material. We haven't looked at that, and as with all suggestions, I will go back and allow them to give some consideration to it. But I'm slightly mystified as to whether there is the wider appeal for these products that we might hope.
Because I do think, I mean, just to finish on that, I mean, I do think some of the products are very attractive. I buy scarves regularly for raffle prizes and things like that, and people are generally very positive about them. And the slate placemats are very good as well.
Positive as he bought a bottle of whisky, John. Michelle, to follow by Michael.
I'll be very quick because most of the areas I wanted to cover have come up already. If we can bear it, just one more little question about the commissioners and office holders. And obviously you've commented that it's, your figures are heavily caveated with continued uncertainties and the associated costs of new commissioners, but have you estimated, assuming that all of the proposed commissioners were put in place, what impact that would have on the budget? I appreciate it's not in here, but have you done that work?
We haven't looked across the piece. We tried to be proportionate as to the point at which we start to do that. We do have input to the creation of the financial memoranda when it gets to that point. So, for example, the Patient Safety Commissioner, which has now been passed by the Parliament, we know that the projected costs there are £644,000 a year. Victims Commissioner is at stage one. I think that's about £615,000 a year. In relation to other proposals, they're all at the draft stage at this point. The Human Rights Bill, which the government is going to bring forward, we understand there's provision in the draft financial memorandum there for more legal support of around about £150,000. So we try to work with government as it's developing its proposals, and similarly with the Non-Government Bills Unit when it's developing proposals on behalf of members, to have input in that and to gather information to see what that cumulative impact would be.
Okay. I mean, I suppose I'm thinking, I mean, there's obviously the setup cost, but also building in the ongoing funding year on year basis. Another question is that, and I suppose it alludes to what the convener opened with, given that some of the Scottish Government's constraints. Have you ever thought of volunteering that the Scottish Parliament should place itself on a fixed budget similar to what the Scottish Government is?
Can you explain a little further what you imagine that might involve?
Well, whilst politically I am as capable as anyone of complaining about the nature of a fixed budget for the Scottish Government,
from a financial perspective, it does bring some discipline and hard choices that are required to be made. So I suppose what I'm exploring with yourself is, and perhaps picking up in the opening comment, have you ever considered advising that your budget should be put in a fixed basis?
Well, as someone who has sat in the corporate body through more than one parliament and has also sat in the corporate body when we went through some very difficult financial times as a country, I know that we applied some very rigorous controls to our budget, which led to significant reductions at one point in the overall cost in terms of the provision, in terms of staff that we had at that given moment. I think I'll turn to David, but I mean, I come back to the fact that in this Parliament in particular, we have been consolidating the views of the last Parliament that we were under-resourced, both in terms of the support that was given to committees and also the very strong representation from parliamentarians themselves that they felt that their own offices were under-resourced, which, in comparison with other parliaments elsewhere in the UK, was actually a reasonable case that was being made. Embracing these changes was a significant increase financially, and I think I should say, correct the record, I think I might have said 80% of our cost as a parliament when I was thinking of office holders at that point. It's 70% of our cost is our parliament, is 70% is the staff cost. I think when that is the case, it's difficult to see what would anything other than a negative consequential impact on our ability to operate as a parliament if we were simply to unilaterally adopt that principle.
Yeah, it's an interesting concept, and I have to say it's not one that I've considered before, so I might give that a bit of further thought. I think the loss of flexibility that Jackson has talked about there would be a major challenge, and I'm thinking in recent years of the additional powers that the Parliament got through the 2016 Scotland Act, the seismic change in leaving the European Union, how we would respond to that. But also the other way, I mean, last year I think Sarah alluded to the fact that when inflation was running at 11%, we brought forward a budget that was about 4.5%. So our ability to flex in different circumstances, giving that up for the perceived benefits of a fixed budget, I think would be a particular challenge.
Made a very compelling argument against fixed budgets. Thank you very much. Just one last final question. It was concerned the cleaning budget. I just wasn't clear. You'd noted the increase, but it said the contract price increase for the 23-24 budget was omitted, and I just wasn't clear. I think, yeah, no, I now, having read it out, I think I understand what that means. We didn't have the base price. Okay, and I think that's clear. I'm just checking my notes. Don't have anything else. Everything else has been covered. Thank you, Convener.
Michael.
Thank you. Briefly returning to the office holders, we have had some conversations in ahead of an inquiry they're about to undertake about the capacity of the corporate body to scrutinise office holders. You said that there's been significant challenge given back to the office holders in this budget process and the bids that they've put in. Does that stretch the capacity of the corporate body to do that work?
I think that as we've come to appreciate the concerns around the growth of office holders, we questioned amongst ourselves the ability of the corporate body to look at and properly scrutinise these matters. I think it's fair to say we did a piece of work ourselves on whether there were other structures that were open to us, but we looked carefully at the legislative framework within which we operate, and the corporate body cannot devolve the responsibility for its scrutiny of office bearers. It is a requirement under the legislation that the corporate body is responsible for these matters. We've therefore sought within our the time that we meet on our agenda to expand the scope that we have for proper scrutiny of the office holders, and we are actually, as we at this time we've been going through a sustained period of having each one of the office holders into the corporate body to explain and justify their budget, but also just to talk more generally about the work that we're doing so that we are increasing, if you like, the interest and scrutiny that we're bringing to the task. But I don't diminish the reality that, as you know, from a corporate body that at one time had to scrutinise two, a corporate body that is now having to scrutinise, is it the eighth, the patient safety commissioner, eight, to a corporate body that might then be invited to scrutinise even more, moreover, scrutinise office holders whose own responsibilities in some instances are increasing as well, becomes something of a challenge. And that's our responsibility from a governance point of view, from the perspective of the actual performance of those office holders. That is a responsibility for parliamentary committees. And in some cases, one or two parliamentary committees have a responsibility for several office holders themselves. And I think accommodating that into their ability to take forward work they might wish to do, to scrutinise legislation and to hold the government to account, is equally a significant challenge. David?
Could I just add that on the staffing side, the pressures are immense as well. I mean, we basically have one full-time member of staff who oversees the whole office holder landscape for us. She has the ability to call on other people on an ad hoc basis, but I really don't think that's sustainable either. I think, as well as the additional office holders we talked about, there are other sources of increased pressures. For example, the UNCRC bill that the Parliament passed just before the Christmas recess. That gives two of the office holders the ability to raise legal action on behalf of the people that they represent. We're not clear on what cost that might add. I talked earlier on about the human rights bill that's coming forward. That won't create a new office holder, but that's likely to significantly increase the remit of the commission there. We also have a members bill that's looking to make radical changes to the FOI regime. And again, that's bound to bring with it additional costs for the information commissioner. So all of these expansions do put incredible pressure on the member of staff that we have. And I'll look to existing budgets to see what can be done there, but it's not against the realms of possibility that might be sitting in front of this committee looking for an increase in the parliamentary capacity in order to continue to oversee the governance of this increasing office holder landscape.
And if you'll allow me, I'd very much like to pay tribute to both Hugh Williams and Janice Creera, who are the members of staff who hugely experienced and whose experience I think we fundamentally rely on as the commissioner landscape grows, because they have done a first-class job, I believe, on behalf of the Parliament, liaising with the various commissioners and assisting and informing the corporate body.
Thanks for those answers. I mean, I'm reasonably satisfied with the answers and detail that you've all given today regarding the commissioners and the office holders. It just feels to me that a further four commissioners added to that workload feels like it's become untenable. I know that we'll see much more of this in the inquiry.
Because I made this comment earlier, at my own group, I find there is a general acceptance of the principle that we have a growing officer landscape. But when it comes to, oh, but don't stand in the way of the commissioner I want to create, there is an individual conflict in those on that proposition. And I think that is one of the things we have to wrestle with.
Jamie?
Just very quickly, one of the things that I noticed was that the contingency budget has decreased by 33%. I was just wondering if you could explain that. Is that a question of being higher in previous years perhaps than it needed to be, or just circumstance?
It's back to where it has been. We had a higher budget last year, which I seem to remember I might actually have been responsible for advocating, because we were in a year where we were uncertain about inflation. I mean, it's worth remembering that at the start of when we presented our budget last year, the forecast of the external bodies was that we would be in negative inflation by April this year, which has proved to be somewhat ambitious. I think the corporate body was slightly cautious at that point about accepting that, and therefore chose to have a higher contingency just to meet what looked to be a much more volatile position in our view than was necessarily being presented. This year, I think we felt that it would be wrong simply to maintain that higher level of contingency, so we brought it back to a figure that is more typical with the one we've had previously.
Okay, that's great. That's all I wanted. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'm just going to finish on the issue of cleaning, only because it's been brought up by both Joan and Michelle. And it's the cleaning budget will increase by 23.7%. So I'm just wondering why to £804,000, and that's not in itself a huge figure. I'm just wondering why it's such a large percentage increase in 1 year.
Sorry. Ian, no, that's simply because we missed, so when setting last year's budget, we missed the contract inflationary increase in the budget. It was just missing. So it has been, we've been paying it in the current year. So essentially what you've got from budget to budget is 2 years worth of contractual increases rather than just the one.
That's fine. Thank you for that clarification. I want to thank our witnesses for their evidence today. We will continue with our budget scrutiny, but first we'll call a 5 minute break until 10:25. Let's kick off. Okay, Ross isn't back, but I'm intending to... For the second part of our evidence session on the Scottish Budget 2024-25, I'd like to welcome to the meeting Shona Robison, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, who's joined by Scottish Government officials, Dr Alison Cumming, Director of Budget and Public Spending, Ellen Lever, Deputy Director, Local Government and Analytical Services, and Dr Andrew Scott, Director of Tax and Revenues, Scottish Government. We have just over 2 hours for this session, and before I open up the discussion, I'd like to invite Ms Robison to make a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'd like to begin by thanking the committee for its work in the pre-budget scrutiny phase, and I look forward to working with you on the Budget Bill. The challenges facing Scotland's public finances are well known to the committee. When we met on the 3rd of October last year, I said that this would be a budget of difficult decisions. The pressures on the 2024-25 Scottish Budget cannot be overstated and, in my view, represent the greatest challenge to any Scottish Government since devolution. We are continuing to manage a wide range of pressures due to volatility from global factors such as the Ukraine's resettlement, the impact of inflation and the cost of living crisis, and of course the ongoing legacy of COVID-19. I'll say again that the UK Government's autumn statement delivered the worst case scenario for Scotland. It contained a fiscal settlement that undermines the viability of public services across the whole of the UK. Our block grant funding for this budget, which is derived from UK government spending decisions, has fallen by 1.2% in real terms since 2022-23. Our capital spending power is due to contract by 10% in real terms over 5 years. As I set out in December, we cannot mitigate every cut that the UK government makes, and we are at the upper limit of the mitigation that can be provided within our devolved settlement and competence. While the UK Government has chosen to prioritise tax cuts at the expense of the NHS and other public services, our values and therefore our choices are very different. Our missions and values of equality, opportunity and community were the guiding principles of this budget: to protect people as best we can, to sustain public services, to support a growing sustainable economy and to address the climate and nature emergencies. At the heart of the budget is our social contract with the people of Scotland, whereby those who earn more are asked to contribute a bit more, where everyone can access universal services and entitlements, and where those who need an extra helping hand will receive targeted additional support. We've chosen to act to do everything in our power to protect Scotland's public services and deliver for the people of Scotland, and this includes a £6.3 billion investment in social security and more than £19.5 billion for health and social care, alongside record funding for local authorities and frontline police and fire services. I welcome the opportunity to meet the committee to discuss the 2024-25 Scottish Budget in more detail and to assist in the scrutiny process.
Okay, thank you very much for that very helpful opening statement. Although, again, you've said that there's a 10% reduction in capital over the next 5 years, but the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said it's 20%, and in page 5 of your own of chapter 1 of your own budget document, it says, and I quote, SFC analysis shows that by 2028-29 our capital funding is set to fall by 20% in real terms in comparison to 2023-24. So do you accept it's a 20% reduction rather than a 10% reduction?
So just let me address that directly. So the analysis from both the SFC and the Scottish Government forecast a significant reduction to our available capital funding over the medium term. The figures cover different time periods and include different assumptions. So the SFC analysis forecasts up to 28-29 in comparison to the 27-28 for the Scottish Government, and the SFC analysis includes assumptions around our capital borrowing policy and financial transactions, which are not included in the Scottish Government analysis. So it depends on what you include, and essentially that is the difference between the figures, and happy to provide more info on that if it would be helpful. If we using the same assumptions as the Scottish Government, the SFC analysis shows an 11% real terms reduction in our capital block grant over 6 years, as opposed to almost 10% over 5 years. And then if you take into account the capital borrowing policy and the FTs, that is the difference. So it will depend on future decisions, of course, which haven't been made around capital borrowing. They're making assumptions, of course, which may well change when we get to that position.
So if the situation is not as bad as we thought, then why is has the housing budget been cut by a third to £375.8 million in the forthcoming year?
Well, the housing budget is very challenging, and the capital budget is a large cut. Whether or not, I take your point about the 20% versus 10-11%, but actually that sustained cut in capital budgets is extremely challenging for the housing budget. If you take into account all of the other challenges that are facing with construction inflation, all of the other challenges, it is a very difficult outlook for housing. Having said that, the investment that we will be making in our housing budget, we believe, will help to lever in private sector investment. The Housing Minister is working with partners, investors and the private sector to look at how we can lever in additional private investment. If you take the figure on the public capital investment, it's about a 13% decrease. One of the main drivers, of course, has been the reduction in financial transactions. They are down to £176 million. The housing budget has been traditionally the recipient of financial transactions, but they have dramatically reduced. And we have had to deploy the financial transactions that we do have, the £176 million, to the Scottish National Investment Bank in order to maintain its capability. So these decisions are not easy. It would be one of the most difficult decisions. I would also say that if the capital availability of funding changes, it would certainly be the key priority for additional capital availability should that position change over the coming weeks and months.
Okay, thanks. It's just that obviously housing has had a particularly serious reduction. Now, you've mentioned one set of figures, but obviously we have to work with what we've actually got in front of us. You know, the Scottish Government's budget 24-25, and on page 53 it shows that the More Homes budget has decreased from 740.1 million in 2023 to 564.6 to 375.8. So that's an almost halving over 2 years at a time of a housing emergency. At the same time, what we've seen is the Scottish Government has invested very significantly in other areas with regard to capital. As we know, a 12.4% increase for Police Scotland, 49%, for example, in digital connectivity. I'm going to mention one or two other increases in a moment when we move on to other areas, but I'm just wondering why that choice has been made, because what the Scottish Government has said, quite rightly, is it's about choices, and one of the things I find wearisome is that nobody really makes choices other than the Scottish Government. Everyone says, you know, there should be more money for everything, right, and no reductions in anything. But I just want to know why the Government has decided that, given the situation in capital, that there would be the capital is decreasing. I think that's just a fact of life. But why housing in particular has had this dunt relative to other areas of the Scottish budget?
Well, partly it's due to the fall in financial transactions. So if you look at CDEL alone, it's a 13% reduction, which is not great, but given the reduction in the capital budget of 10%, that is one of the major challenges. The falling of financial transactions, which have traditionally bolstered the housing budget, has been an additional difficulty. And of course, there's very few areas where you can deploy financial transactions. Housing has traditionally been one. And of course you can't use FTs in other areas of capital investment in the same way. So because they've gone off a cliff, in many ways the housing budget has been disproportionately impacted on that. We then had a decision around the Scottish National Investment Bank, which is the other recipient of financial transactions. And in order to keep keep SNB sustained, we have had the difficult decision to deploy the 176 million FTs to SNB. So, as I say, convener, it would be the area that, should we find ourselves in a better position with capital budgets going forward, or if we manage to get a better position through the spring statement, the spring budget, then of course the housing budget would be the number one priority. Some of the other investments that you've referred to have been particular to projects that have been required in policing and the digital connectivity area. I think we all understand the importance to a number of areas of government, of public life, and investing in that digital capability. And I take your point, given the budgets are reduced, the budgets available to us are reduced both on the resource and capital side. The easy part is finding areas of budget impact. That's the easy bit. The more difficult bit is to put forward a different set of propositions and choices. We have tried to prioritise on the basis of the budgets available. We've had to make difficult choices in order to do that. But part of the budget scrutiny process is to hear alternative propositions coming forward.
Yes, I'm not sure we've heard many alternatives, to be honest. But you talked about levering in private resources to housing. Where are we? Are we on track to still deliver the 110,000 houses that the Scottish Government has pledged? Is private finance keeping up with the demand, filling the gap that has been left by the reduction in public finance?
So, so far, and I should say, for context, we have got a good track record of delivering on affordable housing. We've delivered over 126,000 affordable homes so far. That's 40% more than per head of population in England, 70% more than Wales. So there is a context to this that actually shows a good track record. In terms of the 110,000 by 2032, we have delivered over 14% of that target so far. So the last figures available to the end of September last year shows almost 16,000 affordable homes being delivered towards the 110,000 target. Clearly, there's further to go, and that, because of the really challenging financial position on capital, not just this year but for the foreseeable future, we've had to really turn our attention to innovative finance solutions. So the Housing Minister will come forward with some further detail on this, but he's been engaged with investors, with the private sector, where there is clearly an appetite to invest, particularly in mid-market rent, for example. We need to lever in more of that in order to help us deliver that target.
OK, thank you. Now, sticking with capital, there's been some interesting figures bandied around. I'm looking at page 62 of the Scottish Budget, and there's a couple of issues I want to raise with regard to the Level 3 figures in relation to Trunk Road Network. There was an article in the Sunday Times, actually, which said, and I quote, "The collapse of infrastructure spending to appease the Greens is a national disgrace." And it alleges a 4,000% decrease in spend. I'm not really sure how you can have a 4,000% decrease. I thought 100 was the maximum decrease you can have, so it's a somewhat enumerate article, but its claims is only £12.4 million being invested in A Trunk Road routes. And yet, when I look at the figures on page 62, it says that critical safety, maintenance and infrastructure spend is increasing to £524.7 million, which is a 41% increase. So I'm just wondering if you can tell us a wee bit about these figures and why there is a 41% increase over 1 year in that particular budget.
So this would relate to critical infrastructure. We're continuing to support Scotland's trunk road network, providing over £1 billion for critical safety, adaptation, maintenance and improvement priorities. So this will, I guess, come in waves in terms of where investments are required. So if you look at the commitments made on the A9 dualling programme, including to Matt and to Moy, the A83 at the Rest and Be Thankful, the operation of the M8 Woodside Viaduct. There are at the moment a number of projects that require that investment. Now that, again, will ebb and flow depending on what the kind of critical...
Recognise the figure of £12.4 million, do you?
No, I can't account for journalists picking up of particular figures. I can't reconcile that with the budget figures themselves. I'm not clear where that's come from, to be honest.
Now, one thing about these level three figures in terms of this roads budget, which I found interesting because it's a transparency issue. What it says basically is that trunk road network PPP payments will rise by 3% to £133.9 million. Now, we know that there's PPP expenditures all over the place, my own area for schools, for example, in Edinburgh for hospitals. But I don't see the PPP payments anywhere else in this document unless I haven't read it properly. But I'm just wondering why it's on this, but it doesn't see this page, but it doesn't seem to be elsewhere. It's almost as if the Scottish Government, in compiling this document, it really had to be done in a rush, because of the Open Statement and the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecast and negotiations between parties. But I'm just wonder why that kind of figure appears here, but doesn't seem to appear, the PPP repayment doesn't seem to appear anywhere else.
I think that's a fair question, and we will certainly reflect upon that, because I guess if you look at the NHS line, there could well have been a PPP cost associated with that if it was disaggregated. But Alison, I don't know whether there's anything you could add around why the presentation is different.
I think we are aware that there are long-standing inconsistencies, differences in presentation between portfolios, that it's difficult for us to make a lot of changes to Level 3 budget presentation from 1 year to the next in a way that then maintains that line of sight. It's certainly something that I think it would be legitimate for us to consider ahead of the next spending review as to whether we have the balance right in terms of the presentation of what constitutes a level three. You just have to look down these tables to see that the values vary very significantly, and it will always be a question of judgment. But that's certainly something we'd be happy to work with the committee on in terms of whether we've got the right level of disaggregation, both at level three and level four, and what changes to that disaggregation would enhance Parliament's scrutiny of the budget.
I think we need transparency is fundamental. I think we can't be comparing apples with pears, and we need to be able to have confidence in what we're actually looking at and when we're making comparisons. Now, one of the issues that a number of people from who gave evidence to the committee, particularly their pre-budget report, was regarding the need to grow the tax base. And it has to be said, it's fair to say that there is a level of disappointment with regard to some of the decisions that have been made. So I'm just going to ask about some of those decisions. For example, in wellbeing economy and fair work, there's a 15% reduction to £348.7 million in the enterprise, trade and investment budget. And you've already touched on the Scottish National Investment Bank, but its budget is down 28%. Now, at a time when we need to grow the tax base, improve productivity and create the economic growth, we need to provide the tax revenues to pay for so much else. Why have these decisions been made to reduce, for example, the enterprise budgets?
So, again, these are difficult decisions that, with falling budgets, difficult decisions were going to have to be made. And to be blunt, we've had to prioritise frontline services, particularly our investment in the NHS. And that has meant some very difficult decisions elsewhere. What I would say is it's also against a backdrop of average earnings in Scotland now growing faster than in the UK. We've seen a record income tax receipts, with Scottish income tax alone now forecast to raise about £18.8 billion in 24-25 to help fund services. So there's a number of indicators that show on productivity as well that the Scottish economy is improving in its performance. And in terms of where we are supporting investment specifically, it won't surprise you that we are looking at our investment in net zero, particularly and we're working with business investors to launch a new green industrial strategy. And we have tried to ensure that when it comes to our enterprise agencies, that they will be focused on the key priorities. They won't be able to do everything, and they will need to do fewer things, but to prioritise where they deliver their support services. In an ideal world with budgets not reducing, we wouldn't have had to make any of these decisions, but we have, and the prioritisation for all of our public bodies will mean that they won't be able to do the range of things that we have previously asked them to do, but they will have to focus on key priorities.
Okay, but if you look at the figures on page 88 for enterprise, which includes Highlands and Islands, Innovation Industries, South of Scotland, etc., it's £348.7 million, which is about 0.6% of the entire Scottish budget. But the reason I'm quite confused about the prioritisation that's been involved is that if we actually look at some of the other figures that the Scottish Government has brought in, has got in this budget, we'll see that student support has increased from 925.1 to 1,484.6 million, which is a 60.4% increase in a single year in student support. I mean, that can't be right, surely. But if we look at page 72, it's sitting there in the level 3 figures. So that increase in student support alone is almost twice what the entire enterprise budget is to try and help grow the economy.
I think that also includes, though, the UK-funded AME, which is student debt, which is something we don't have control over, and that would be included in the figure. Alison, do you want to say something?
Yeah, there's a very significant increase in the UK-funded AME, which is based in the main on actuarial valuations on the student loan book. And changes in assumptions year on year, and we do tend to see quite significant variability, which is why that spend's classed as AME, and we're not allowed to use that budget for other purposes. So that was the increase from 420.8 million to 804.1 million in the bottom row of table A5.06.
So it's not us putting additional money into student support, albeit that wouldn't in itself be a bad thing to do. It's because of that, Amy.
But when you're putting together these budgets, again, I go back to transparency. I mean, it looks as if that's a decision made by the Scottish Government. I mean, I look at UKME, but there's all these other figures on top of that. It looks as if this is almost a figure that you have to play with. Should that not be kind of separated out, really, from the Scottish budget to give a much more rational and reasonable view of the budget so that you can actually do appropriate comparisons?
I think that's not an unreasonable suggestion that if we were able to give some kind of explanation as to why that isn't part of the kind of purchasing power, if you like, of the budget given to higher education student support, but is it really an accounting issue, then perhaps a kind of some kind of note to try and explain that it may not be a bad idea going forward.
Yeah, I mean, I think we want to look at these figures three-dimensionally rather than kind of two-dimensionally, wherever possible. Now, again, go back to choices, you talked about protecting the NHS, the resources up 4.3%, police up 5.6%, support for ferry services, I'm pleased to say, is up 23.3%. So there are a number of areas where they have went up. But why did you decide what those percentages were? Why did you decide, for example, 4.3 for NHS but 5.6 for policing? What was the decision in terms of that?
Some of it will relate to particular areas of delivery that are required at a particular time. So I think part of that, and I'll turn to Alison for the detail, but I think part of that will be police pensions and the requirement for us to support police pensions, which is reflected in the budget for police. Some of that will relate to your particular cycles of requirement of investment, and the police budget is reflective of that. Alison, I don't know if you want to say any more.
Yeah, I mean, these are, as the Deputy First Minister had said, matters of judgment for ministers and for Cabinet, recognising that public services are often starting at a very different place in terms of their reform journey and in terms of the pressures that are facing them in the years ahead. So there has been that increase in the resource budget for the Scottish Police Authority to support their frontline service delivery, recognising that policing have made a number of reductions in recent years. We've seen that reduction in police officer numbers, for example, through previous budgets. And this was about allowing a positive budget decision to support the sustainability of policing in Scotland and allow investment in new technologies such as body-worn video cameras that will bring further reform and efficiency opportunities in the future. The UK autumn statement obviously heightened the trade-offs between some of these decisions as to exactly what percentage uplift different services have received, and it's clear that there will be reform challenges across all public services. But I suppose we don't apply a single formula as to this is the number that should be applied to all public services. It is through considering the evidence and the analysis and the evidence that comes through from the sectors themselves, actually through the pre-budget scrutiny, all comes to bear in when the final decisions are being taken on those allocative choices.
Okay, one of the things we discussed with Tom Arthur when he came with regard to and discussed the autumn revisions was we looked at budget moving in year, as you know, and he talked about reductions from the Forestry and Land Scotland budget, and also we talked about Creative Scotland having reductions in their budget in year. And of course it turned out that in actual fact they weren't really getting reductions in year in terms of their spending power, because Creative Scotland had £17 million reserves. I'm not sure how much Forestry and Land Scotland had, but they were able to find £6 million in their reserves. And of course asked Mr Arthur at the time whether the Scottish Government would look to see how much money all these bodies have got actually in reserve across the piece, because if that's two bodies and there's like 131 or something, there must be hundreds of millions of pounds stashed in all these organisations. Has that work begun? And is there any likelihood that additional resources will be found from... Because, I mean, local authorities and the Scottish Government itself doesn't have huge amounts of cash reserves. One or two local authorities might, but most of them are down to the bare bones on that, and the Scottish Government doesn't have much of a reserve. So is it appropriate that all these bodies kind of up to, for example, 3 months, equivalent to 3 months of its revenue, kept in reserve, while at the same time frontline services are being squeezed?
So I think it's a good point. I think that we can't ignore reserves when we are looking at the financial position of an organisation. So, for example, Strathclyde Passenger Transport, the point of their very significant reserves was a point taken into account when it came to looking at their budget settlement. So money is money, and if organisations are sitting on large reserves, then of course that should be seen as part of the public purse. I guess where we would be sympathetic to an organisation that has built up reserves for a purpose. So if an organisation is going to be taking forward a considerable period and piece of work of reform, and they are going to use reserves for that purpose, or they have an investment plan that's going to spike, and they've got reserves that is going to be part of their investment plan for that particular period of time, then all of these things will be taken into consideration when it comes to whether or not they should be required to use reserves. I mean, I guess you could consider the point of, if you look at the need to deploy reserves in times of budgetary constraint, then, you know, this is a time where reserves need to be brought in to the picture. So the short answer is yes, they are. And those individual discussions with public bodies around their size and shape, their function, their investment plans, the level of their reserve will be part of that discussion.
Okay, thank you. Now, one of the issues that's come to the fore in evidence and indeed in submissions, and I've got the Scottish Retail Consortium submission just in front of me here, is the impact of the income tax changes. So, for example, Scottish Retail Consortium has said that that the tax changes, which have a marginal rate of some 69.5%, which I understand from Professor Bell last week is the highest marginal rate in Europe for people who will be paying the new top rate of £75,000 rate of tax. They said it's potentially more expensive and challenging for employers in Scotland to attract and retain the specialist and senior talent they need. Now, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said that they expect about £144 million on paper to be collected from that £75,000 to £125,140 band. But of that £144 million, they expect about £70 million, nearly half, to be lost by to behavioural change. But in the rate above £125,140, they say that it will be only £8 million will be collected in reality out of the £56 million because of behavioural change. So a couple of things. Is there more focus on raising tax from higher, the best paid people in our society than actually broadening the tax base? And what is the impact on, what message is it sending to people outside Scotland about coming to Scotland and Scotland being a place in which to live, work and invest?
So these decisions are carefully considered And I would point out that, you know, the new advanced rate is estimated to impact only the highest earning 5% of taxpayers. But nevertheless, it is a decision that was not taken lightly. We have, of course, looked very carefully at the assessment and, from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on any behavioural change, and that's factored into the net gain benefit from those tax changes. So they estimate £82 million will be raised from that advanced rate change, which is not insignificant. We also have the analysis that is being worked on by HMRC that will be made publicly available later this year, that builds on the evaluation of the 2018-19 income tax reforms, which really found very limited evidence of Scottish taxpayers lowering their declared income, for example, in response to increasing tax rates. Also, I think it's important to note that we still see net migration of working age people from the rest of the UK to Scotland in a net gain position. It averaged about 7,000 per year, and that, you know, over time adds significantly to Scotland's workforce and obviously important in terms of growing the economy. But we absolutely should not be complacent about these matters, and we keep them very much under review. Taken as a whole, you know, the tax changes that we've made over a period of time compared to the rest of the UK, SFC now estimate are worth about £1.5 billion. So a significant contribution to public services. You started off talking about marginal rate, which again, yeah, we have to be very cognizant of. In terms of the top rate, the marginal rate of earnings between 100,000 and 125,140 is mainly due to the personal allowance taper rate, which of course is entirely reserved, and that marginal rate of taxpayers in the rest of the UK is also significant. So we are not complacent, and we don't take these decisions lightly, but in the most challenging of budgetary circumstances, if we hadn't made that decision, then that would have been meant even less money available for public services at a time of constraint.
The Scottish tax system is clearly progressive, but when you add it on top, layer it on top with the UK system, you know, with all the anomalies there, you know, for example, which you've touched on, you know, for example, national insurance going down from 10 to 2%, you know, the impact of child benefit, except withdrawals, etc., you know, and indeed, you know, there's also, you know, people who, the first 14,800 that they earn, that's taken away as well, you know, that tax-free element's also taken away. Is the Scottish Government... it almost seems as the Scottish Government is saying this is a progressive system and we're not going to take into account the UK system at all, because it seems as if it's just added on top, but doesn't say, well, people in Scotland earning X should pay Y in tax, and are there going to be any attempts to try and smooth that out? So, for example, someone at the moment who earns £44,000 a year will pay a marginal tax rate of 52% with, when you add up in Scotland with a higher rate in national insurance, but if they earn £54,000, they'll have a marginal rate of 44%.
I mean, I guess this is part of the challenge of having a hybrid system and the incomplete devolution of tax powers. You're going to have anomalies that exist. I think the Fraser Valander had, you know, said, addressing the specific point you've made, would require, you know, significant changes to the basic and intermediate rates. I think the the process around this, let alone the impact, is going to be brought into very sharp focus if there are further tax changes made at the spring budget, for example. A very, very advanced point in our budget process that inevitably then impacts on the tax and spend decisions of this place. So I think to say that it's not an ideal system is probably the understatement of the year, but it is far from ideal. And what we've tried to do in amongst all of that complexity is to try to carve out a more progressive system. But there are areas where it rubs up against the UK system in a way that's not ideal, and there's no getting away from that.
Lots of areas still to cover, but I know that colleagues will want to dip their toes into those, so I'm going to open up the session. First will be Michael, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. There were some reports, Deputy First Minister, at the weekend about the funding that was allocated to the Clyde Gateway regeneration project, which appears to have been a typographical error in the budget. Is there any more errors in the budget that you would like to bring to committees and Parliament's attention at the moment, or is that an isolated one?
So there are always some errors that occur, and it is regrettable. The discussions have taken place with Clyde Gateway over the Christmas New Year period to make sure that they understand the budgetary position. And I think just the volume of information and changes that inevitably are made can sometimes lead to errors like that. But I don't.
More you want to bring to our attention?
Well, there's no widespread errors. That is one that's been picked up. We're not aware of any others. So.
We've also had we had evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on the lack of a public pay policy provided to them under the protocol to which the government and the SFC are signatories. You and I have exchanged letters on this issue. Perhaps you set out to committee why the government failed despite deadlines, extensions to deadlines that was set out in evidence we've received that you did not provide that public pay policy to the SFC.
So this is not dissimilar to what happened the last budget when pay policy was set out in the March of last year. I think this budget is because of the difficulty in being able to predict the outlook in the light of the spring budget that is coming, that could potentially make some significant changes to our fiscal outlook, then I think it's important to understand what that will look like as part of the issuing of pay metrics. I think to do so now with that level of uncertainty would not be the right thing to do. So that is why the timeframes are what they are. I accept that we would want in an ideal world to have aligned that with the budget, but given all of the difficulties in forecasts, then that has proven to be very difficult. So we'll set out our plans for public sector pay following the spring budget, and which will provide an update on the fiscal outlook and most importantly on the UK government's public spending policy, which obviously could impact on our budgets. And given pay is such a large part of our budget, as I set out in my letter to you, I think it's prudent to do that.
So these are key figures for the SFC to be able to put in place the forecasts upon which your budget is based. It was pretty clear from the Fiscal Commission's evidence to us that they want to see this policy. It's in the Concordat protocol that you have laid out. So are you saying that the government, that's 2 years in a row now, the government's not provided that information to the Fiscal Commission? Do you not intend to provide it in the future? Is that a decision you...
So the protocol sets out the information sharing expected to take place in the lead up to the budget, and we provided the SFC with the latest position on public sector pay costs for 22-23 and 23-24, and you know, we commented on the pay award assumptions being made for future years, but on the specific in terms of the metrics, I think it would be prudent, given we have the unusual position of a spring budget coming that could potentially have a major impact on the spending available, even though our assumptions, of course, are made on the autumn budget. We have this spring budget coming that potentially could change significantly.
A budget would change, a UK budget would change the amount of money we would have?
I think the extent potentially of the changes in spring budget, given it's an election year and some of the noises being made through the media of what could happen vis-a-vis income tax changes that have a profound impact on our budget, I think it is an unusual set of circumstances of some of the extent of some of the changes that might be made in the spring budget.
Can move on to the issue of education and universities. There's press coverage this morning regarding the cut made to of £28.5 million to universities, and your stated aim, I think, within that the universities, let me quote, additional savings to be made in the HE sector, including from reducing first-year university places. How many university places for Scottish students are you looking for universities to cut?
So, first of all, let me say that the investment in HE and FE is like two billion, which is still a substantial investment. The media discussion has centred around the position of 1,200 places. So if you go back to the origins of this, essentially during COVID, due to the assessment processes put in place for assessing hires at the time of COVID, if you remember, they became a different process of continual assessment, and therefore there was a big spike in those who were gaining university entrance. So we used some of the COVID monies to fund those additional 1,200 places for universities in order to address that spike. We've maintained those places for 2 years without the COVID funding available. So that COVID funding ended from the UK government, and we've managed to keep those places going for 2 years, but the position is not a sustainable one. So that spike in places due to COVID is going to have to return to the pre-COVID levels of university
so
places.
So that would account for between £4 and £5 million of the 28.5 million. So roughly 1,200 to 1,300 students, as that bubble in the student placements runs through the system. So using the same metrics, I would reckon that that's about 3,800 student places in the 28.5 million. Is that a number is that what you're asking universities to cut?
That's not a number I'm familiar with. There isn't a number as such, because the Scottish Funding Council is still to have those discussions with the university sector around the places that will be available. The point I'm making is that the 1,200 has been the figure that has been referred to, and I'm explaining to you why that bubble is there and the legacy of it. But going forward, in terms of the number of places that will be settled, is a discussion that the Funding Council is having with the universities in order to land in a place that is affordable and sustainable.
This comes at the same time as there's been a collapse in the West African market, Nigerian students in particular not coming to the UK, a very difficult, challenging time for all universities in Scotland as a result of that, so a double hit to the budget. But in your equality statement in the budget, you say there's a significant risk to learners from poorer backgrounds as a result of what this measure you've taken. Do you care to explain what that significant risk is?
Well, first of all, on the international students, that is a risk because of UK government's counting of those students in terms of trying to get the numbers down of people coming to the UK. I don't think that's the right thing to do. And I think it is going to put pressure on our university sector. In terms of the position of students from a more deprived background, actually we've seen increasing numbers of students from more deprived backgrounds being able to access university places. That's something that we want to see continue, and we want to see that trend continuing, and that attainment gap and the opportunity gap continuing to be addressed. So that is something that we will continue to pursue as a very clear policy objective.
This is in your own equality statement published with the budget. You have said under your name there's a significant risk to learners from poorer backgrounds as a result of the cut you've made. So what is that significant risk as you understand it?
Well, I guess it's in recognition that if there are less places for university students, then that could pose a risk to those from less well-off backgrounds, which is why, though, through things like access opportunities to university, the non-traditional routes that support students from less well-off backgrounds, that's important that we maintain those supports in order to make sure that doesn't happen. So risks identified don't necessarily come to fruition because of the policies that we will take.
It's really because non-research intensive universities are more reliant on the teaching grant than research intensive universities. So modern universities are more reliant on the money that you are cutting. But you can't tell us today how that cut is going to be distributed across those universities.
Well, no, because the Scottish Funding Council haven't completed their discussions with the sector. But I do take the point that those universities that are more relying on the teaching grant are, particularly those smaller universities, are in a different financial position to some of the larger universities sitting with quite large reserves that we were talking about earlier on. I know that they're in a different position, and that will be taken into account in terms of those discussions going forward. But I think, as I said to the convener earlier on, the easy bit is to point to areas of the budget where, with falling resources, challenges are there. And the more difficult bit is to put forward the proposition of what different decisions would be made.
Can you tell committee what the budget for FE will be, further education?
Give me a second. So essentially the SFC again will be discussing with the sector. I think what is fair to say though is that the funds available to colleges at the start of 24-25 are expected to be very similar to the funds invested by colleges in the 23-24 financial year. A number of in-year savings were taken in demand-led areas of spend that were lower than had been anticipated. And we anticipate that the allocations will be very similar to the core funding that colleges received and are actually investing in 23-24, and that the careful management of demand-led spend, including a continuation of savings delivered this financial year, is what the college sector is already working on and delivering, and that's what the SFC would support them to do.
We're a month on, Deputy First Minister. It doesn't feel very clear, I have to say. I mean, I'll give you a quote from a very senior member of the college sector that I spoke to this week. I think we've had four or five different figures: flat cash, 8.4% reduction, 4.7% reduction, 1.5% reduction. We've even been told by some Scottish Government officials that is slightly up on this year. Honestly, pick a number, any number. That is the level of confusion in the college sector, a sector that, frankly, is getting applications now for next year. When will they know what their budget is for the coming year?
So, as I said, the funds available to colleges are expected to be very similar to the funds invested by colleges in the 23-24 financial year. And I think it's about making sure that the looking at the in-year savings that were made because of demand-led budgets, that is factored in to what colleges will actually require to spend. So those discussions will continue with SFC to make sure that the college sector has the resources it requires to be able to deliver what we would... That particularly on the demand-led expenditure that is required. I don't know, Alison, if you have anything to add.
No, I think all I would add, Deputy First Minister, is that this is the normal process that is undertaken between the Scottish Funding Council and institutions, colleges and universities around how the budgets are then deployed and how this comes through into numbers. Obviously, the position with colleges, I know some of the evidence you received last week has referred to some of the in-year budgetary changes, and I think that would be the reason for the different numbers that you were quoting there would be around against the opening budget position for 23-24 as opposed to taking account of changes that were made in year to the funding, which, as the Deputy First Minister has already set out, was in large part driven by changes in demand-led programmes within the overall envelope, but also decisions that were taken. So I don't, from an overall budgetary perspective, as we see it, the normal process is being followed. And while, you know, we may be 4 weeks onwards, there's been a Christmas period in that the education sector would take as well, so that we know that these discussions are progressing in the normal way.
I mean, so it's not been described to me as the normal or the usual position, I have to say, Dr. Cumming. I mean, it's been described in a quote here as a shambles, that there's far less information available to the college sector this year than there has been in previous years at this point. And you'll understand that budgets are set and courses are advertised and people apply for what they do and those applications are coming in. And colleges don't know whether they can run the courses because they don't know what their budget is. So if I can say that other things said to me by college leaders, that the current situation is soul-destroying, that we are staring into the abyss. No direction, no leadership, no clarity, no empathy, no solutions, and no clue. Deputy Minister, what would you say to college leaders that are telling MSPs that that is the situation they find themselves in?
Well, I think, as I've set out, the financial position across the board is really challenging, and the easy thing is to point to where it's challenging, but the harder thing is to come up with solutions. Every part of the public sector is impacted here.
I think you're questioning an issue of the quantum here. I'm asking, when will they know what their budget is?
There is no difference to the process that's being deployed here, and the process with the Scottish Funding Council with the college sector, it will continue. The position will be clarified as quickly as possible. The final position will take into account some of the demand-led expenditure to make sure that the landing position of colleges is what is required in order to make sure that they can deliver the services that they are required to deliver. But There is no part of the public sector here that is not going to be impacted in terms of the quantum, but the process is no different this year than it's been in other years. Challenging in terms of the quantum, I accept, but the process is no different.
So you reject shambles?
I wouldn't accept any of that. Challenging, it is challenging. Okay. It's challenging for every part of the public sector. And the easy bit is to find examples of that. The harder bit is to come up with alternatives.
Okay.
And so everybody around this table is able to do that, of course.
So the all of these areas, regeneration funding, university funding, college funding, vital issues about skills and regeneration, vital for growth, and we've had an awful lot of evidence as a committee about how important it is we get growth, and you've said this budget is about growth. How would you then react to the comments and the evidence we've had from the Fraser of Allender committee, as a committee on 9th January, who said, I would not say that the budget is particularly focused on growth. David Bell on the same day said, it does not look like the budget particularly favours economic growth. It's meant to be one of the key missions. These are a variety of examples that are, by your own qualification, by your own target, what you're intending to do, you're not meeting them, and people don't believe you're meeting them.
So, first of all, growth is a priority, and earlier on I set out some of the economic indicators in the Scottish economy that actually show an improving position. The investments we are making, particularly in net zero and green energy, are strategic investments that are the right investments, encouraged by the investor panel to make those strategic investments. But there's no getting away from the fact that with less money, both on the resource side and particularly on the capital side, that making the same investments that we would have wanted to have made with less money, we can't do that because there's less money. So we've had to make some very difficult decisions around where we make those investments. So for our enterprise agencies, for example, we need them to focus on the priorities. There'll be things that they're not able to do, but they need to focus on key priorities. Our capital investment is geared to try to use public capital in a way that is strategic, that also levers in private sector investment. So all of these are going to be critical to continuing to see the improvements in economic performance that I laid out earlier in the committee session. But I come back to the point, with less money, we've had to make difficult decisions, and that has impacted on areas where we would rather have not had to make those decisions. But there's no escaping that those decisions had to be made somewhere in the budget, and those are the decisions and priorities that we've made.
Thank you, Kabir.
Michelle, to be followed by Ross.
And just to put something on the record, in last week's Education, Children and Young People's Committee, Minister Graeme Day pointed out that the starting point for colleges next year will be slightly better, and I'm quoting here, only slightly better, I stress, than the finishing point for this year. My first kind of rapid-fire question is, picking up on the point you made there, did the opposition parties put forward budget proposals this year for what they would like to see cut? In the kind of nature of a very difficult budget, as you set out?
Not so far.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, I want to pick up on a theme that the convener opened around housing. Now, we're seeing really quite difficult and a difficult and challenging operating environment. Obviously, we've seen the issue with Stuart Milne, but also Merchant Homes Partnership have gone into liquidation. Harbour Homes are stopping development of affordable housing. Springfield have already stopped development of affordable housing and build to rent, and are now selling some of its land bank. And in the main, they're all citing very challenging trading conditions with inflation, a higher cost base, buyer uncertainty, and so on. But the challenge then of to what extent now are, given that, you confident of the commitment to build 110,000 affordable homes by 2032 in the light of that? How confident are you about that now, and do you fully anticipate that that will need to slip being realistic?
So I think, first of all, you're right to identify some of the very big challenges on the construction sector more widely, and the housing construction sector more specifically. So, you know, interest rates so high, inflation, cost base, all of that has led to some of the difficult decisions of particular companies that you mentioned earlier on. So that's the backdrop. We then have, you know, what can we do in terms of the investment that we are making, and that the £556 million investment that we will make. How do we make that deliver the biggest impact? So, you know, I mentioned earlier on the Housing Minister's discussions with private sector about how we can potentially lever in more investment into mid-market rent opportunities. There is an appetite there, I think, within the investment sector to invest in housing, and we need to harness that in a way that can provide a business model to do so. So Housing Minister's working on that. In terms of the target, so it's fair to say that the profiling of the target will need to change. So it's never a straight road on a target anyway. There are always bumps and peaks and troughs of delivery. And it's fair to say that I think we would be looking at sort of back-end peaks while we have a very difficult outlook at the moment with capital. That might change, but at the moment, that's the outlook in terms of our capital budget reduction. So we have to look at alternatives. We can't rely on public capital. It makes the delivery of the target very challenging indeed. Having said that, we're already over 14% into the delivery of that specific target, but you know, there's still a long way to go.
And on that, obviously, I've noted what you said about what you've said about levering in additional private investment, but that's the money coming, but we've got to have the companies who are actually effectively trading. And also, I take it from what you're describing, these are long-term investments, most likely pension companies, I would suggest, where there's probably a high demand, and that it will take a long time to get those kind of things structured. Now, the other area that has been noted with concern is the rent freeze, and that's why some companies, such as Springfield Properties, have moved away at the present time from build to rent. Now, build to rent is realistically the only way we can get to the scale of the build we need, or one of the critical ways. I think business is accepting of rent caps, but it's rent freezes that make for a perception of a less benign operating environment than elsewhere. So I would ask how the juggling, recognising that dynamic for businesses to actually come back into the market, particularly around build to rent, against what I fully understand has been protecting people through some very difficult times, but is even a function itself actually a chronic issue with supply. I mean, that's why rents were going up, because so it's a cyclical problem. So does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that rent freezes have given a perception and certainly introduced a cooling in people wanting to kind of proceed with the likes of build to rent?
I think given the current climate, it's maybe a little bit more challenging to disaggregate what the factors are. So, you know,
But some of them have stated that is a factor. So, they've made clear, two companies that I've mentioned today have made that clear.
Yeah, so if you look, I'll come back to Springfield in a second. So the likes of Stuart Milne did very little in terms of affordable housing. It wasn't mm-hmm. their kind of main area of focus. At Springfield, except that, you know, that is one of their bigger areas of focus, but they've also got all of the other pressures that have been very, very challenging for them. We have to keep a careful eye on any of our government policies and monitor and evaluate any impact that they have. Clearly, the protection and of tenants' rights and trying to keep rents affordable where in order to try and ensure that some of the huge challenges around cost of living were not impacting on tenants in situ tenants' ability to afford their rent. So the reasons were well set out. But we have to monitor and be very careful around any unintended consequences. So that's something that we are listening to the sector over and we're keeping a very close eye on.
Okay, thank you. Carrying on, one of the other areas of interest that you may already have been brought to your attention was around the use of the money off ScotWind to fund day-to-day revenue expenditure. Now, Professor Bell made comment of that, and I'm going to quote, he said, "The ScotWind money can be thought of as equivalent to a sovereign wealth fund, and a sovereign wealth fund should be used to support future generations because it's a sort of one-off payment." I wondered what thinking the Scottish Government had given to the use and that breaching, if you like, of the sovereign wealth fund principle, which I know we've often commented that the arbitrary waste, it would appear, of money from the UK government of the benefit of oil for future generations. So I'd appreciate hearing more about your thinking that made you consider, despite that, to still spend it on day-to-day revenue.
I take your point, and in an ideal world, with the ability to not have to plug gaps in day-to-day spend, then I can see the appeal of building a sovereign wealth fund with ScotWind. So the Scottish Government raised £756 million through the ScotWind auction. That is not an insubstantial amount of money, but in order to sustain public services, we really had no option but to use all of the tools at our disposal, including deploying funding available for ScotWind revenues. Had our budgets been in a different position, then perhaps different decisions could have been made. But the resource spending review allocates £310 million for use in 23-24 and £350 million to be used in 24-25. There are some requirements to bring forward some of that funding into 23-24 because of the budgetary position. And without it, the position of some of the difficult decisions we would have had to have made beyond the ones we have would have been even more profound. So I think it just shows the limitations, perhaps, of devolved fiscal powers that we're having to utilise those resources in that way. We do absolutely recognise the importance of offshore wind, which is why, of course, the budget itself kick-starts the commitment to up to £500 million to anchor a new offshore wind supply chain in Scotland, because we recognise that there is a potential longevity of benefit from those investments. But we've not, because of the position of public finances, we have had very little option other than to utilise it.
Yeah. Well, I suppose the outlook for public sector finances isn't going to get any better. We've got that guaranteed, really, from the Conservatives, and certainly no further offerings from the Labour Party should the government change. So would the Cabinet Secretary consider in future years setting fiscal rules around this money to protect it? Because I'm pretty confident that had various UK governments been challenged over not building any kind of fund with the oil money, would have cited public sector pressures in exactly the same way. So will the Cabinet Secretary consider developing and then sticking to fiscal rules? Otherwise, we are embedding ourselves into a financially dependent situation rather than the opposite. Because if you look at what Norway's managed to do, so I ask, would the Cabinet Secretary consider that?
I mean, these are things, of course, that we will continue to consider. The difficulty is, if I was sitting here in this evidence session and I had £350 million unallocated in a whatever fund you want to call it, I can imagine that there would be calls for that money to be deployed in order to avoid some of the difficult decisions, understandably. So because of the constraints and the lack of fiscal levers, it essentially means that because of the tightness of the fiscal position that we're having to draw on that, if that position changes going forward and we're able to build a reserve and a fund that could help to build a capacity for future years for infrastructure investment or particular projects, of course that would be the preference. I can't guarantee that, though, given the outlook you've described yourself, that whether it's the ongoing fiscal priorities of the current UK government or it looks like similar spending plans of an alternative government being kind of stuck to, then it doesn't bode well for the Scottish budget being anything other than fiscally tight for some time to come. But in principle, I don't disagree.
I wanted to move on and talk a little about public sector reform. I mean, obviously, I've seen the phases that have been set out at the moment. But I'm aware that this committee didn't get a financial strategy to accompany that, which was a commitment made by the former Deputy First Minister in March 2023. Is the intention to want an appropriate point once these early kind of scoping phases are out of the way to provide an updated financial strategy, and if so, what sort of timescales are we working to?
Yes, that would be the intention. I think that the problem at the moment is the level of uncertainty is very challenging in being able to set out the position that is then not going to potentially be buffeted and changed by fiscal events that are forthcoming. So I think the MTFS in May will be an opportunity to be able to look at that longer term. I have provided just before Christmas the an updated report on some of the reform programme, which is a absolutely critical part of the financial outlook, because I think even setting aside the decisions, the fiscal decisions made in the autumn statement, the outlook is likely to remain challenging for all the reasons that I set out in the previous MTFS. So being able to give you regular updates of the work that is ongoing to get to a more sustainable position would be my intention on a sort of 6-monthly basis of giving you updates, particularly focused on the reforms that we are taking forward in order to get to a more sustainable position in terms of public sector size and function.
On that, I mean, I know that you stated you require all Scottish Government portfolios to set out savings and reform plans. If I were cynical, which of course I am, I would sort of suggest that turkeys don't tend to vote for Christmas. So whilst asking them to consider really tightening up reform of themselves, or even suggesting that perhaps they don't need to exist, I think it's 129 bodies rather than 131 convener, seems optimistic. Because the problem is when you create a body, it takes on a life of its own, it develops a vested interest. And this is a question I actually asked a former Deputy First Minister, because this is just my experience, that turkeys don't vote for Christmas and they may suggest some tinkering type reforms, but will be unwilling, and for very obvious reasons, to make the scope and scale of reforms that are really needed to you to bring forward some savings. I'd appreciate your thoughts on that, and that's my last question.
I don't think your cynicism is totally misplaced, and you know, every organisation, as you say, takes on a life of its own. So first of all, I think in terms of the, you know, the growth of public bodies, we've been very clear that you know, the controls and assumptions and presumptions need to change, so that there should be a presumption against forming a new body as a solution to a problem. And now Cabinet will require to give its approval to any suggestion or proposal for a new public body, because it has perhaps in the past become the kind of default of, you know, whether it's a new piece of legislation, a new function, it has to have a new public body, which of course it doesn't necessarily, given that there are already existing public bodies that could potentially take on the functions. So then the question is, what do we do with the landscape that exists? And I think there are a number of aspects to that. One is some rapid work around controls over the size and function of those existing public bodies. And without a doubt, the workforce controls that we're putting in place are going to impact on all public bodies. They may not impact to the same extent on each public body, but they will impact, because some public bodies are in a different position than others in terms of their growth of role and function as opposed to others. There's then areas that are de minimis of what you would expect public bodies to be doing. So looking at shared services, for example, is a must. Does every public body need its own HR, payroll, is it? Which is actually one of the reasons that the investment in digital is important, because some of the investment in digital capability can provide potentially a one door for all of the kind of reliance support functions for public bodies, rather than them having their own systems, which brings a huge benefit in terms of cost and sustainability. So that investment by Scottish Government in digital, providing a digital system to support, you know, payroll and HR. And it has many other additional benefits that probably through for the avoidance of using up more time, I'll not go into in any detail, but happy to, you know, maintain a dialogue with the committee about the detail of this going forward. The more challenging question, I think, is more that is beyond just government. A lot of the public bodies and roles that have emerged, commissioners and so on so forth, is also in the parliamentary space. And I think we do have to perhaps take a step back and ask ourselves a question with a, you know, population size that we have, is that the right landscape required going forward as part of the sustainability and public sector efficiency that we need to be quite rigorous about?
By Liz.
Deputy First Minister, after my questions, I'm going to have to pop next door for about 5 minutes to substitute in Health Committee and then come back in. But apologies if I finish my questions and then just get up and leave. Just following on from Michelle Thompson's line of questioning around public sector reform and on disposal of public sector assets and touching on some of the discussion in last week's debate around the estate. You mentioned shared services between different public bodies, but I'm wondering how much coordination there is when it comes to reducing the size of the public sector estate. Thinking particularly of Glasgow City Centre. I realise most of the Scottish Government's office space there is rented rather than owned, but there is some owned property in the, but there's a lot of owned property in the public sector there. The City Council has an objective to significantly increase the city centre population. Glasgow City Centre doesn't particularly need more office space. Is there an active discussion ongoing in an instance like that with the City Council around, well, if we're disposing of what is currently office space, what is the potential to have this converted into housing to meet the City Council's objectives? I'm not asking very specifically about that, but as an example of coordination across the public sector, sharing services is one thing, but when we're looking at things like reducing the size of the public sector estate, is that level of coordination ongoing, or is it a siloed approach where the government simply needs to get this property out of its portfolio? If anybody's willing to buy it, great, they can have it.
So some of it will be about the Scottish Government making decisions about the requirements for its estate, and some of that will be more rapid. Because decisions need to be made around, you know, extension of leases and so on and so forth. But without a doubt, there is a sharp focus now on looking at the need for buildings in the light of people working in different ways, in the light of needing to meet net zero criteria. What are the buildings that are going to be required over the next 5 to 10 years and beyond? There's then, I guess, a further opportunity of, well, where are the opportunities for co-location? Where are the opportunities for repurposing? So those discussions are taking place, particularly around in our city environments. And I think the local authorities have a key role in that, given their asset base as well and their requirements to meet same net zero targets and the changes to working patterns as well. So I think there is a prize here that can save money, yes, but can also provide a more appropriate efficient set of buildings and assets that can deliver a better service, a better environment for the staff working in them, but also a better service to the public.
Thanks. Looking at the spending side, obviously there is, I believe, total cross-party agreement that we should, wherever possible, focus on outcome-based budgeting rather than the focus on inputs, but that's pretty hard when, I mean, ultimately you're primary obligation here is to produce a balanced budget and then within the confines of that try to do things like outcome-based budgeting. But taking that approach, there's £1 billion more going into the social security budget, really significant increase in cash terms and as a percentage of that overall budget. What are the outcomes of that in terms of meeting our statutory commitments around child poverty reduction, for example? Does that £1 billion of additional spending just prevent poverty and inequality getting worse in the light of the cost of living crisis? Or is that going to take us further forward on the objectives that both are in statute in terms of the child poverty target, but also some of the objectives in the government's broader missions, particularly inequality?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's always the way with budgets that the focus, whether it's of committee sessions or plenary sessions, is always going to be on the areas of the budget where it's more constrained and it's more challenging, rather than the areas that are seeing additional investment. And the social security additional investment is absolutely focused on reducing poverty and supporting those who are most vulnerable. £6.3 billion investment is, you know, now one of the areas of Scottish Government that has become one of the kind of key pillars of spend, and will undoubtedly help to support those who are most vulnerable. We've been able to give an inflation uplift to the supports, which has led to obviously an increase in Scottish Child Payment, which is going to be welcomed, I think, by many families, particularly at these difficult times. So I would see this very much as an investment in people. And I think it is one of the areas that has been a conscious decision and political choice.
Can I press you a wee bit on that, though? Because I agree with you absolutely that operating social security payments in line with inflation would be widely welcomed, particularly by those in receipt of them who really need them. But operating in line with inflation isn't going to lift anybody out of poverty. It's just going to obviously prevent them from falling further into it. And I'm not saying that, clearly that is not a bad thing in and of itself. What I'm trying to understand, though, is for a £1 billion of additional spending, which I clearly welcome, is that taking us any further forward? Are we reducing poverty and inequality as a result? Or is £1 billion simply what we need to spend to mitigate the decisions of the UK government and the context of the cost of living crisis?
So I think partly it's mitigation, but of course our investment in social security has always gone beyond, for a number of years now, the block grant adjustments. So that additional investment is investment beyond the consequentials that flow to social security, which I would argue show an additional investment in reducing poverty. And you can, I think, see through the investment in whether it's Scottish Child Payment or the additional investment in adult disability payment, for example, that the importance of trying to support people who are the most vulnerable in our society. So I would say it's a bit of both. Partly mitigation, and if you look at the wider spend, whether it's on discretionary housing payments, whether it's on Scottish Welfare Fund, some of that is clearly mitigating UK government welfare policies, without which people would be, well, they wouldn't be able to sustain their tenancies, or they wouldn't be able to manage in a cost of living crisis. We've also taken decisions, for example, like to re-establish the Independent Living Fund, which is again going to help to support people living independently in their own home, hopefully avoid people losing their independence, and will help to support people in work, for example, who are maintaining employment of people who have disabilities. So it is a balance.
If I could take a similar line of questioning around spending on climate and net zero, but looking specifically at the offshore wind supply chain money that you mentioned, I think it's £69 million or thereabouts. We quite recently, towards the end of last year, had that very positive report from the Fraser Valander Institute, 50% job growth in the sector in just 1 year. I think it's somewhere between 12,000 and 17,000 additional jobs. I can't remember the exact number. What are you expecting to be the benefit of that £69 million? Has there been any attempt to quantify that in terms of expected jobs created, return to the public purse in terms of tax revenue, etc.? How can we measure the value for money of that £69 million?
There is, and I can forward that on to the committee. I don't have that in front of me, but there has been an analysis of the impact of, well, the £500 million investment, £69 million is the first tranche of that, very explicitly recommended by the investor panel. So they've said, the one key investment the Scottish Government can make is in that sector that will have a return that is substantial for the Scottish economy. So, we talked earlier on about constrained capital resources, and you've then got to be pretty strategic about where you can invest, given there's less money to to invest. And I think that is an area that we've identified is important. And the Fraser of Allender figures that you referred to, I think, show that there is a that Scotland is seen as a place, a good place to invest because of that certainty of objective, of you know, very clear, no ifs, no buts. This is an area of the economy that will continue to see investment, and that speaks to international investors who are looking to make choices about where they invest.
Yeah, I mean, I can see that just in the number of planning applications in my region, various elements of the renewable energy economy. If I could jump to tax just for a moment and behaviour change, following up on some of the convener's questions, I'd be interested to understand a little bit better how much in-house analysis the government does of potential behaviour change versus the work that SFC does for government. So, for example, some of the concerns that have been raised, which I think in a lot of instances are over-egged, but there you go. Some of the concerns that have been raised around avoidance of the new income tax rate are around people simply putting more money into their pension pot, for example. Does the government conduct any analysis, even within the public sector, of how many of the higher paid public servants have engaged in, have increased pension contributions, given we're now 5 years into to income tax divergence? It would just be good to get an understanding of how much of this analysis takes place in-house within government versus SFC work, and where it is SFC work. Are there questions that you specifically pose to the SFC, points of data that you would like to have?
So part of it is the work of the SFC, which of course is important. They put that through through their analysis before giving us the figures for any tax take. Is already based on the potential for behaviour change, and that's important. But it's not just SFC, so the work that HMRC is doing is going to be important in that external analysis. So they have they're looking at two separate pieces of analysis. The first one is a data set covering, you know, the incomes and location of UK taxpayers over a 12-year period up to 2021-22, and that would look at, you know, historic trends of intra-UK migration of taxpayers at different income levels and whether there's been any obvious factors impacting trends. And the second one expands on their 2021 empirical study on taxable income elasticities by considering responses in labour market participation and intra-UK migration to the 2018-19 income tax reform. So I guess both pieces will make an important contribution to the debate. There'll always be an element of uncertainty about the impact that past policy changes have had. We've not had any evidence presented to us of, you know, substantial behavioural change, but that's why this work is important, to make sure that we are able to have that independent analysis. And we still see, as I mentioned earlier on, that net in-migration of taxpayers to Scotland from elsewhere in the UK, which is positive. What we need is a bit more drilling down, I think, of you know, whether there's any differential of you know, in terms of you know, what level of earnings people have and so on. So we'll keep that very much under review, and we look forward to HMRC publishing.
Just finally on that, as you said, it is independent analysis, whether it's HMRC or SFC, but does the Scottish Government ever pose questions to them? Do you ever, you know, knowing that HMRC is about to undertake X exercise, does the government ever say, we would particularly value having Y point of data? Is this something that you're going to collect and analyse?
Andrew, do you want to?
Yes, both of the studies that the DFM has referred to were initiated by the Scottish Government in consultation with others. And they are overseen by HMRC, the OBR, the SFC, the Welsh Assembly Government and the Fraser of Allender Institute as well. It is a collective that's ensuring technical rigour, but the work was paid for by the Scottish Government.
That's useful. Thanks very much, Andrew. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Listed before by Joan.
Deputy First Minister, you said in your budget speech on the 19th of December, and you've reiterated again that this was a budget for growth. So can I ask you, when it comes to growth in terms of improving skills and addressing economic activity, which your predecessor, John Swinney, had said at one time was one of the biggest challenges, why have you made substantial cuts to every area of the budget that would help improving skills and economic activity? You've cut the Scottish Funding Council budget, you've cut the employability budget, you've cut the enterprise budget, you've cut the SNIB budget, and you've increased tax on those whose high-level skills we desperately need in Scotland, leading people like Sandy Begbie to say, and I quote, "It's likely to inhibit the ability of our sector to create jobs and retain and attract the talent we need." And very similar comments from Tracy Black of the CBI, Sarah Thiem from Prosper, David Ovens from Archangel Group, Alexandra Doherty and Johnson Carmichael, David Lonsdale, they're all saying the same things, that this budget will not do anything to improve the situation with skills. And David Bell told us last week that it is not really a budget as far as opportunity is concerned. He's right, Cabinet Secretary, isn't he?
Well, I think this budget in very, very difficult circumstances is trying to invest in as many areas as possible to deliver on the government's objectives, but there is less money to be invested. So if we were to have increased all of the areas that you have referred to, then that would have meant reductions in budgets elsewhere. So when you have to make choices to deliver a balanced budget, these choices are not easy. But in consultation with Neil Gray and other ministers, what we will do is to make sure that, for example, our enterprise agencies are focused on the key things that absolutely matter, that the skills review that Withers has delivered challenge to us, or it is to make sure that our skills delivery landscape, which has a huge multi-billion investment, delivers a better impact for the economy, that our apprenticeships, for example, and Graham Day has taken forward some very important work to make sure that our apprenticeship system and what it delivers and our, you know, and through to our college offerings as well is more aligned to what businesses actually say they need in terms of the skills gap that they have within their sectors. So, and taken, of course, with some of the strategic investments that we're making in green energy and renewables, we have tried to align a declining amount of resources, particularly on the capital side, to the best impact that we can. These decisions are not easy, and I would, if you're asking me, would I have preferred not to have had to make them? And, of course, that would be my conclusion as well. But in the light of falling budgets, we have had to be clear and will and are being clear with our agencies of what we're what the focus needs to be on delivery going forward.
But Cabinet Secretary, the response from the business community is very damning. In fact, it's excoriating in some of its comments, and the particular focus is this concern about skills and trying to address the economic inactivity issue. And I cannot understand why, if that is seen as the major priority for the government, that you would seek to put pressure on colleges who do so much work to try not just to ensure that students have the right skills, but they're actually involved in retraining, which is important, just as important in terms of the employment in the economy. And cutting things like employability and enterprise, these are absolutely critical, surely, to the success of the economy. And, you know, what I find it very difficult to understand is that, you know, Neil Gray has been very upfront by saying that there's a new deal between the Scottish Government and business, and that there will be, and I quote, no surprises when it comes to that new deal. But that's not the view of the business community, is it?
Well, let me say, first of all, on the issue of employability, since 2018, the devolved employability services have reached over 100,000 people. They continue to do some very important work. There is a move towards a system that is trying to make it easier for users to navigate and focus and more focused. The local employability partnerships are being given responsibility to deliver services in their areas that meet the needs of their users and local local labour markets. So that is where the focus of employability services will be. But there's no doubt that, you know, whether it's the in-year savings this year or last year, where employability funding was reduced, that has been an unfortunate consequence of the pressure on Scottish Government budgets. And had we made decisions elsewhere and not in employability, then I'm sure those issues would be being raised with me today. In terms of the position of business, so on NDR, for example, I know that businesses that are in those sectors would have preferred the Scottish Government to have passed on the NDR business tax cuts. Had we done that, then there would have been substantially less funding for the NHS and public services. So these ultimately come down to choices that we have had to make that have been difficult, but I couldn't in all conscience cut business taxes at the expense of investment in the NHS. So when you're sitting with the choices in front of us of having to balance a budget and having to make those decisions around business tax cuts or NHS funding, then you know, I've been really clear that there was only ever going to be one answer to that question, and it had to be prioritising the investment in the NHS over business tax cuts at this time anyway.
Would one of the choices then have been to scrap the National Care Service situation and that money could be deployed elsewhere?
Well, the National Care Service is going to be an important reform that will lead to more consistency and improvement in the quality of care services. And having worked in the sector for many years, I can tell Liz Smith and others that that consistency and the requirement for consistent quality is something that users of services will tell you is a priority, and users of services are very keen that we make progress with the National Care Service. And the building blocks and infrastructure for the National Care Service are being put in place. We're working with local government to make the progress that needs to be made. It's going to take longer to establish, but it is a very important reform that in the longer term will deliver huge benefits for those who receive care services. The investment in the team that is supporting the delivery of this is, you know, a fraction of the cost of the delivery of social care. And if we weren't investing in a team to deliver it, then I think questions would be asked around whether we were putting in place the building blocks that were necessary to make sure the National Care Service is going to be delivered. So, you know, that is what we're doing in order to make sure there is a successful delivery of the NCS.
I think these are questions that are already being asked by nursing unions, by local government, by many people on the front line, but no doubt we'll come to that as we go to stage one. Can I just go back to seek some clarity, please, about the education situation, because again, when it comes to improving skills and addressing the economic inactivity, this education budget is crucial. Mr. Mara asked you, he quoted, I think I'm correct in saying that your budget says that additional savings are to be made in the higher education sector, including from reducing first-year university places, and he asked you how many would be removed, and he offered the view that that, using the government's own statistics, might be 3,700. Can you just clarify that that is the number that is likely to be the decision from government and Scottish Funding Council?
No, there's no number or figure that I'm aware of that relates to that figure.
Is there any number at all?
The only number that I am aware of is the one that I spoke about earlier on, which is the 1,200 COVID places, which are the bubble that we have sustained funding for an additional 2 years out of Scottish Government resources, because the COVID money was stopped by the UK Government that funded those places initially. Scottish Government kept those places going with Scottish Government funding for 2 years, but we are no longer going to be able to sustain that. So beyond that, there is no figure that has been agreed with the university sector, because those discussions are ongoing around what is the, you know, what will the university sector deliver. So those discussions are not concluded.
So just for clarity, have you asked the Scottish Funding Council to go back to the number of places that were in the number of places that existed pre-COVID? Is that what you're trying to tell us?
So the 1,200 is the COVID and pre-COVID number, yes. So the 1,200 places can no longer be sustained. We sustained them for 2 years in order to try to prevent them ending earlier than we would have. If we'd essentially followed the UK government COVID funding, then they would have ended 2 years ago, because that funding ended. What I'm saying to you is that we kept those extra places going for another 2 years, but we're not going to be able to sustain that going forward.
So there will be a reduction in the number of Scottish domiciled places in first year?
Well, the 1,200 will return that bubble back to the pre-bubble position.
Can I ask what you expect to happen when it comes to universities offering places to foreign students? Will that increase?
Well, the position with international students is constrained by the UK government's position on the decisions it's made that makes it more difficult for international students to come to university in the UK, particularly around their ability to bring in families. So I think that is a very short-sighted policy from the UK government. I think the universities are pretty clear that it will impact on the numbers of international students coming to the UK, not just to Scotland but elsewhere in these islands, and I think that is unfortunate and not a policy that is helpful to the university sector going forward.
But it is your understanding that with the reduction in the number of places for domiciled Scots that will happen, that there will be pressure for universities to take more foreign students as a result of that financial pressure. Is that correct?
They are modelling in terms of the balance between domestic students and international students is something that they continue to develop and will continue to develop. The 1,200 places that I described in terms of pre-COVID and COVID will not be a surprise to the university, because those places were never going to be sustained in the long term, and I think the university should be more than aware of that. As I say, we've kept it going with Scottish Government resources beyond the time of that money being removed by the UK government, and that will return the numbers to that pre-COVID level. So the universities should have been anticipating that would be the case going forward.
But the Scottish Government has always made the case that Scottish domiciled students are extremely important in university education, which I would agree with. And one of the reasons they're so important is because their likelihood of staying in Scotland to work beyond when they graduate is exceptionally important. And we desperately need well-qualified graduates to stay in Scotland. Is the policies that you are enacting just now not undermining our ability to keep many of our best qualified student graduates in Scotland?
Well, it is very important that we try to encourage those who come to study here, or Scottish domiciled, and indeed those who come to study here, to remain living and working in Scotland. And we certainly try to encourage that. If you're talking about the 1,200 places specifically, then, you know, had that money continued to be invested, as we called for at the time, that the COVID money should not go off a cliff, then of course we may have been able to make different decisions. But that was never going to be a position that was going to be able to be sustained going forward, because it was a mechanism that was deployed to take account of that spike in university applicants that was due to that COVID period. So, you know, it was a short-term intervention, which we've actually delivered for 2 years beyond which the COVID money's covered. So, you know, the position with Scottish domiciled students in terms of support, we want to see the universities continue to provide and deliver opportunities for Scottish domiciled students, but we cannot continue to fund the COVID 1,200 bubble that was funded previously. The resources are simply not there to do so.
And has this made the Scottish Government think about reforming the funding process in higher education?
I think we always keep the position under review. If you're talking about tuition fees, then, you know, the importance of having free tuition as not having a barrier to those entering into higher education. We talked earlier on about those from a more deprived background going to university, that the gap has closed. There are more students from more deprived communities going to university. I think that is partly due to the fact that we have free tuition and people are not going to be taking on those levels of debt seen elsewhere in these islands. So if you're asking me, are we reviewing the position of free tuition, then no, that is not something that we're reviewing.
I wasn't asking about that, actually. I was just asking about whether you're going to review the whole process of higher education funding, because I think that, you know, this budget has clarified some of the difficulties that we're facing in the future. Can I just finish on another point of clarification, if I may? We've had various discussions about how the government models behavioural change when it comes to tax, which is an issue that is bothering so many people in the business community. And we've obviously discussed statistics that have come from the Fraser Valander Institute and also SPICE. And I think the convener gave you some statistics at the beginning that, you know, the economists are saying that for incomes over the 125,000, the behavioural change might be as little as 8 million. And for those incomes between 75,000 and 125,000, it probably be about 74 million. Are these the numbers that the Scottish Government's own analysis arrived at?
We base our figures on the Scottish Fiscal Commission's analysis that take into account behavioural change, and we recognise it's something that we require to have more evidence around, which is why I earlier on talked about the work that HMRC are doing. So far, I would say that the evidence in front of us is that there is not any widespread concern about behavioural impact, and we still see net immigration. But, you know, the reason that the HMRC work is important is to be able to drill further into that in terms of whether we can establish the within various income bands, whether there's any change or behavioural change that the HMRC research is going to show. Andrew, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
Well, I think that's right. I mean, next year when the budget's presented, it will have the benefit of the two new studies that are being completed now. And that will be the point at which the Fiscal Commission reviews its judgments about the extent of behavioural change that is likely. Now, it might take these studies and decide to increase the adjustments it makes for behaviours, or it might leave them alone. It takes account of a very wide range of international evidence as it forms a view. But always we have tended to follow its judgments about the extent of behavioural change and putting forward our estimates.
Yeah, thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. John, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks, convener. If I can maybe start just picking up one or two points that have been touched on already. Concerning the housing budget and the numbers of affordable houses to be built, and you said, or it has been suggested, that there might be more private investment coming in. Would that include, like, giving lower grants? Because obviously the government money is Housing Association grant mainly. So are you thinking of reducing the level of grants so that there's more borrowing?
So the work that the Housing Minister is taking forward is looking at what the business model might be for levering in additional investment. So it might look a bit different from the traditional delivery that housing associations will continue to deliver. And of course, they raise private investment as well to deliver on their targets. I think what we're looking at here is whether or not there is, in addition to that, scope to lever in additional investment that we can underpin with Scottish Government investment, that we can help to lever into particular delivery models, like, for example, the mid-market rent market. So the Housing Minister has been working on this for some time, and once that work has come to a conclusion, he will be able to set out in more detail what that might look like.
Because really, it seems to me the key difference is how much is grant and how much is other investment, and that can be, it gets called private investment and so on, but it's really a loan, or whether it came from a pension fund or a bank. In a sense, that doesn't matter, because you've got to have interest and so on, and that's got to be covered by the rent. So I'm just seeking some reassurance that there won't be a big change between the grant and borrowing.
The models that are being used by the housing associations and local authorities in terms of their delivery models, I don't foresee much change to in terms of how their business model works. What we're talking about here is in addition to that, how we might be able to lever in private investment by looking at a business model that is attractive enough, that has a guaranteed revenue stream that de-risks to some extent, but will be able to add value to the delivery of our social housing delivery partners in terms of what they will be delivering. So that's what's being looked at the moment.
Okay. Michael Mara mentioned the pay policy, and so I'm just wanting to press you a little bit on the figures. I mean, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have assumed 4.5%, and we've already had the SPCB this morning, and they're looking at a 6.7% increase. So can you give us any indication what kind of increases we're talking about for pay?
I can't give you a figure because those are the metrics that are being looked at the moment, and trying to do that without knowing what the spring budget is going to bring is very, very difficult because of the potential impact that might have on our spending assumptions. And given pay is the large part of the spending assumptions, it is material to what can be delivered. Also, we need to take inflation into account. So the prediction of inflation is that it will get at or below 3%. We would take cognizant of those factors as well. I think it's hopefully not a disputed fact that we have, through the very high inflation and cost of living pressures, have supported pay deals to a larger extent than anywhere else in these islands in terms of trying to settle and avoid costly industrial action, which has come at a cost to the budget in year compared to published budget last year and the year before, has been a substantial, I think, £900 million beyond what was budgeted for. So it is a huge cost, and in a year of constrained finance, getting the pay metrics right is going to be absolutely critical to the affordability of our budget.
Because presumably, I mean, inflation could end up higher than we're hoping if, for example, all the shipping has to go around South Africa instead of going through the Suez Canal.
I think all of these external factors are concerning about where inflation ends up. We can only make the assumptions that are based on the best estimates that are made by the key organisations that are projecting where inflation will land, but it is not guaranteed, and it's material clearly to where pay ends up landing in terms of the pay metrics.
Okay. Can I ask you about the council tax freeze and both the mechanics of it, I think, and the logic of it? I mean, can you tell us what the aim of the council tax freeze is? Is it to help people in most poverty? And also, there's obviously a bit of debate over the £144 million, if that's enough. But whether or not it is enough, it kind of depletes the public purse as a whole, doesn't it?
So the council tax freeze was designed, I guess, as a lever to try and help household budgets that continue to be under pressure. And it's an attempt to try to do that. I said at the outset it was important to try and deliver a balanced budget that recognised the needs of households, the needs of public services, and indeed the needs of business. And we've got the lowest poundage in the UK again for the sixth year running. So I would contend that in difficult circumstances we've delivered a budget that is balanced in its intent, very different from the UK government budget, which is almost exclusively in favour of tax cuts at the expense of public services. So the council tax freeze is one lever where we can help to support household budgets. The figure is based on circa 5% increase, so looking at what the projected increases were and taking an average, it lands us in that space. It's not far off the Fraser of Allender Institute analysis, once you've taken out of their analysis the multiplier effect, which was about £188 million of their analysis, which of course we're not pursuing in the light of, I think, lack of support for it among local government, apart from anything else. Once you take that out of the figure left by Fraser of Allender Institute is not far off the 144, I think it was 148. The process, I'm continuing to discuss with COSLA what the process will be in order for local government to access that £144 million, and we'll continue to do that over the next few weeks.
I mean, if I can just press you a little bit, I mean, other people have argued that it would have been better to use the money, say, for the Scottish Child Payment to boost it further, because that would really have targeted the poorest people. Because would I not be right in saying that the poorest people are not really paying council tax? And a lot of ordinary people have had, you know, 5, 6, 7% increase in their pension, in their wages. They're paying that kind of increase for most things, albeit more for energy. And, I mean, I just had a constituent yesterday who came to my surgery and said, I'm happy to pay a bit more council tax.
So, first of all, you know, the intention would be that the council tax freeze is a one-year intervention. So it would be difficult to, you know, make comparisons of funding something that would be an ongoing cost to increase the Scottish child payment, which of course is increasing, given it's increasing in line with inflation to £26.70. And of course, when you think back to where Scottish child payments started, it is, you know, considerably higher than it was, and has, you know, estimated that it has having a substantial impact on child poverty and reducing child poverty levels by 5 percentage points. So I think our investment in Scottish child payment is there for all to see. In terms of the point about impact of the council tax, actually, those on lower incomes pay a larger percentage of their income on council tax. So you could argue that actually the benefit will be felt most keenly by those on lower to medium incomes, because it is a higher proportion of their income, which is, of course, the one of the reasons the multiplier was mooted in the first place, because of that differential in the of what the proportion of people's income and they pay in the higher council tax bands. So it does, I think, have probably a larger impact on those on lower to medium incomes.
Okay, thank you. On a different point, I've recently actually joined the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, so they are absolutely delighted at the increase in the spending on Social Security. I mean, £5 billion up to £6 billion is quite a jump compared to other parts of the budget. Do you have any concern that this is getting a little bit out of control?
So we need to be cognisant of sustainability, and it is an area that has seen continued growth from the inception of Social Security Scotland and the move of benefits and supports from the DWP and the development of new supports here in Scotland. It is a growing part of the budget, and £1 billion of investment to £6.3 billion is substantial. So I think it's the right investment for the right reasons, but we need to make sure, as part of the fiscal sustainability going forward, that the investment in Social Security is also sustainable going forward. So it's something that we are very aware of, and I think I set out MTFS last year that going forward and looking at that financial sustainability, that the growing share and investment in Social Security Scotland was a considerable element of that. So it's something that we're very cognisant of.
Okay. Another subject. I've had a fair bit of interaction with the hospitality sector recently, and they've been going on and on about how they wanted the kind of relief that was given in England. Now, I think England made a mistake in making it across the board, because it seems to me some hospitality businesses are doing incredibly well. So I do agree with your principles, I understand it, of targeting some of the NDR relief at a specific sector, and you've chosen the islands. Can you just say something about why the islands, and if there's any other sectors you think need it as well?
So I think it's fair to say that, you know, had money been available in a way that didn't lead to absolutely hard choices between, you know, NDR relief for funding the health service, that I would have wanted to have done more for hospitality, given that, you know, there are in post-COVID environment challenges for the sector. I'm not unsympathetic to that, but as I laid out earlier on, these are stark choices that have to be made. And, you know, when you put into context that out of the £310 million of consequentials for 24-25, £260 million were for business tax cuts, and 10.8 was for the NHS, we couldn't possibly have followed through with those spending priorities, because I would be sitting here being asked about the funding for the NHS, quite rightly. So we looked at what we could do, and of course the freezing of the poundage, the lowest poundage for the 6 year running, is not unsubstantial. The small business bonus goes further than anywhere else in these islands, so the reliefs are targeted. The islands, I think we're in part recognition of the particular challenges that hospitality in our island communities have suffered. Some of the transport interruptions as well, I think it's in recognition of some of that. And I think it will give us some good evidence as well of what difference supports do make to the hospitality sector, because I'm aware that even with some of the reliefs that have been provided down south, we're still seeing quite a challenging environment for the hospitality, and actually quite a mix. Some businesses doing well, others not so well. There will be various reasons for that. Going forward, we have committed to continuing discussions with the hospitality sector about whether there's something, should resources allow, that we could do that's more focused on supporting hospitality outside of the reliefs structure that exists at the moment. And we'll continue to look at that. And I'm very sympathetic to doing more in the future should resources become available.
Thank you. Again, a different subject. Back to capital expenditure. Now, and some of these are quite small amounts in the scheme of things, but just over the last couple of days, there's been concern raised. One was SPT. Now, you said that SPT have considerable reserves. I had a quick look at their accounts. I think they've only got 12 million what they call non-earmarked reserves. So it's not a huge amount for an organisation with a turnover of 74 million. But there were suggestions raised that, for example, East Kilbride Station might have to be delayed if they don't get, SPT doesn't have funding to put in. And another example, which affects my area, is Clyde Gateway, who I think they're losing their core capital funding of 5 million, which again could put a project at Shawfield in jeopardy. Do you think these projects can still go ahead?
I would anticipate that they can. There may need to, the time frame of delivery of them, it may need to reflect the very challenging financial environment and the capital budget challenges. But, you know, we'll continue to work with SPT and Clyde Gateway to look at how they, the profiling of the delivery of these projects. The projects remain important, and we want to work with them to look at how they can continue to deliver on those commitments.
Okay, thank you. And if I can finish with a kind of more general question. There's been a number of suggestions about the national outcomes and how they have informed the budget and national performance framework, obviously. So can you clarify, were they taken as the starting point for the budget, or were they, did they come in at the end? Okay, well, I'll give you my second half as well. The tax advisory group, was it part of forming the budget?
So on the last point, the tax advisory group is more about the long-term position of our tax policies in terms of the strategic nature of them and the longer-term plan for our tax position in Scotland, and looking beyond year-to-year budget horizons. It was never intended to be an input to each individual budget. Apart from anything else, the divergence of views around the table at the tax advisory group, I think, would probably not land in a space of collective kind of agreement. So, and you know, and that's why we have those divergent views for that rigour and challenge about the strategic position of tax policy going forward. In terms of the performance framework, it remains, you know, really important for priorities, for delivery on those priorities. And you can overlay that with First Minister's key missions of honing down on what actually is really important and how can we focus and prioritise, given we have less to go around, how can we prioritise and focus on the things that really matter, and how we constructed the budget had that as a starting point.
Good afternoon. Firstly, can I draw members' attention to my register of interest as a partner in a farming business and as a Highlands Alliance MSP, somebody who lives in a rural community. I'm going to focus my first few questions on that area. Agricultural support has been cut by £33 million. A similar amount has been cut from the forestry budget, £7 million lost from the marine budget, land reform funding slashed by £3.5 million. It's around about £80 million in total from the land. The Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands budget. That's a bad budget for rural Scotland. So can I ask, Cabinet Secretary, when you were considering the budget, what concerns did you have over the impact of these cuts on rural areas?
So again, in a tough financial environment, we've had to look at the priorities given within the rally budget. We will continue to provide farmers, crofters and land managers with the most generous package of direct support in the UK, worth over £600 million in 2024-25. We will also continue to support people farming and crofting in our most remote and fragile areas through £65 million for the less favoured areas scheme in 24-25. And I think we're the only country in the UK providing that vital support. And we've committed to delivering a new round of agri-environment investment as part of the overall £30 million budget. So I would contend that in a tough financial round, we have prioritised what we are able to invest in. We've also prioritised things like peatland restoration, investing £26.9 million to help achieve the targets. And we've worked with Scottish Forestry, utilising some of their reserves, but making sure that that's done in partnership with them and to make sure that they can continue to deliver, particularly on their tree planting targets. So, tough budgets, but we've tried to prioritise within that what the priorities are within the sector.
I'm not sure Scotland's farmers and crofters will feel very prioritised by a £33 million budget cut. But one of the issues that has come up and came up at last week's meeting was the lack of clarity of how decisions are made and perhaps a lack of consistency too. And you mentioned forestry. I mentioned forestry and you and talked about tree planting there. The forestry budget went up £10 million for this year. It was then cut by over £30 million. It's now being cut by over £30 million for next year. What's the rationale behind that?
Well, the forestry budget will look at the forestry budget in terms of the resources that they had, so the reserves that I mentioned earlier on, and looking at the targets that they have and how they can continue to deliver on those. But these, are difficult decisions that have had to be made, and we, if those decisions had not been made, then the reductions in budget would need to be made elsewhere. So, we are going to work with whether it's Forestry Scotland or any other organisation to make sure that they can deliver on the core ambitions that they have set out, and that work continues.
I mean, would you accept that, for stakeholders, for those that are applying for grants, for those that obviously that forestry is vitally important. It's quite difficult to have confidence that this is a consistent and considered response where there's cuts one year, investment one year, and then swinging cuts the following year.
If you look at the funding for woodland creation, for example, which has been prioritised, then it will facilitate around, 9,000 hectares of new planting and will contribute to climate change targets and net zero delivery. Scottish Forestry has a good track record of approving more new woodland applications, which is actually a record, I think, that they've done. The work that they will be able to do will be focused on some of the key areas of delivery. They won't be able to do everything, and as same with any public organisation, we expect them to prioritise the investments that they have to make. I guess I come back to the point I've made throughout this session that, if we have less money to go around, then we've had to be clear with organisations about the priorities. We can't expect them to deliver everything if they don't have the resources to do that. So prioritisation is critical, and that's what we would expect Scottish Forestry to do, along with all the other organisations that are helping to deliver in rural Scotland.
Okay, can I have I'll look at two other organisations that are vitally important to rural Scotland, and we've touched upon economic growth earlier. Highlands Islands Enterprises budget has continued to fall, cut by another £8 million this next year. The South of Scotland Enterprise Agency will lose £7 million. You said earlier that enterprise agencies will be focused on key things that matter. What will those things be, and what have they been doing over the last few years that haven't been key things that matter?
Well, the key things that matter will be prioritised along with their partners and the Scottish Government in terms of delivery, of supporting business, of investment, making sure that they align with the key priorities for delivery. I think what we have recognised is that sometimes we ask our enterprise agencies to do 101 things. We can't ask them to do 101 things if resources are constrained. So as ministers, we need to be really clear about what are the key things of delivery in terms of their core functions, to avoid duplication of things that perhaps other organisations are doing, and to make sure that they are focused on the key interventions that their organisation can bring to the table, working with others that will help to ensure that there is the investment in the key sectors for growth, whether that's in Highlands and Islands or in South of Scotland, that they support business start-up and expansion in the key sectors that they are focused upon. But sometimes as ministers, we can be guilty of asking them to do a myriad of things, and that's where we need to be really clear that the priorities that we set for our enterprise agencies or indeed any other public organisation takes account of the resources that are available at their disposal.
So would you accept then that they will, you're asking them to do less and probably fewer businesses will be helped?
We're asking them to focus on the key things that will make a difference, and perhaps some of the other things that we've traditionally asked them to do will need to happen in slower time. So those will be garnered in the letters that we'll issue to each enterprise agency around these are the key things that that will be asked to deliver over 24-25, and some of the things that are not going to be key priorities will have to either not happen or happen in slower time.
And the South of Economy Committee when we did an inquiry into business support, which obviously included the enterprise bodies and Business Gateway. I'd be interested to know what things that they've been that haven't been priorities. But just for clarification, can I touch on Business Gateway, because it's not mentioned in the budget at all. Previously it was mentioned, although funding had been cut. Is there any government support going into Business Gateway for next year?
I'll get Alison maybe just to check that. The point I would also just make around whether it's enterprise agencies or indeed Business Gateway, that when you ask businesses themselves what makes a difference and how our enterprise agencies can best assist, they're not always aligned to the same priorities. So I think there is a discussion to be had around what does the evidence tell us of what has the biggest impact? And in times of constrained resource, it's really important that we prioritise. In terms of the Business Gateway, we might have to come back. We're going to have to come back to you on that, if that's okay. We'll write to the committee specifically with Business Gateway.
Okay, thanks for that. Just a couple of other kind of quick areas I wanted to have a look at. We've talked about the council tax freeze, and you've said obviously that it's looking at an average of around about circa 5%. I take it you accept then that there will be winners and losers in terms of the councils, because councils like Orkney Islands Council, where I'm from, we're looking at a 10% increase. They will be substantially underfunded given this, if you're looking at a 5% figure. So there'll be winners and losers.
It would not have been viable to have a funding arrangement for the council tax freeze that was based on what each individual local authority said that it was going to put their council tax up. So I don't think COSLA or indeed the 32 leaders of local authorities would have agreed with one authority getting 10%, another authority getting 3%, depending on the projection. I think there would have probably been an outcry, to be honest, if that had been the proposition. So there was always going to have to be an averaging of what, where does that land in terms of the quantum. I think the quantum, as I said earlier, is not out of line with Fraser Valander analysis. What I would say, though, is that I do recognise that there are some particular issues take Orkney, for example. I am well aware through my discussions with the leader of Orkney Council that there are some structural issues around their funding through SENA. And in actual fact, there are some distributional issues for rural authorities more generally, but Orkney has some particular issues that we need to look to see how we can support that going forward.
That's be something you will be looking at, because obviously, I mean, you can. I understand what you're saying. The council wouldn't necessarily be supportive of differentiated deals, but each council has different circumstances. They have to deliver their public services, and rural and island communities have particular challenges.
So I know that COSLA are looking at some work around the distribution. I'll put me Ellen in a sec around the distribution of resources, but it's very difficult, and I can remember this going back decades, of COSLA trying to agree within itself distributional changes, because trying to get 32 leaders with their own particular interests from their own council's position to agree to a position that perhaps doesn't benefit them is incredibly difficult. But COSLA's operation, of course, in terms of its distribution, is by agreement. So it makes it very difficult to make change.
Because so, you're obviously introducing this council, you've made this commitment to this council tax freeze, so your responsibility, there's a responsibility for you to make it work.
Well, so the issues for Orkney go well beyond the council tax freeze. It's one example they're difficult, but the issues go well beyond that, and they're involved with SENA and how that and how the distribution more generally works or doesn't work for individual local authorities. We continue to discuss with Orkney about how we can help to resolve some of that in the short, medium and longer term. Ellen, I don't know whether you want to come in on that specifically.
I'm not on the distribution formula in relation to the local government settlement, so separate to the council tax freeze. As the Deputy First Minister has said, there's a kind of clear mechanism and joint work that happens between the Scottish Government and local government through COSLA to keep the distribution formula under review. But any changes to that formula require the agreement of COSLA primarily. So that there is a kind of set governance procedure in place there. And as the Deputy First Minister has said, there's a piece of work that COSLA have asked the Improvement Service and others to lean in on in relation to the islands and the particular needs of the islands as they're represented within the distribution formula. That would be at the earliest for the next budget that piece of work would conclude. But that there are other matters on which we have ongoing discussion with individual councils as well as with COSLA as a whole in relation to distribution, but that would be a separate matter to the council tax freeze.
Just one very quick, one more thing. The convener highlighted earlier, and you've mentioned about, and John Mason I think talked as well about reserves. I mean, I take it you know how much money is held by public bodies in reserve across Scotland.
Yes, I don't have that at the top of my head, but yes, we have that information. Not all organisations are public bodies, so universities are not public bodies, so I don't have insight into what each of them has in terms of reserves. But in terms of public bodies, yes, and local government, we know the level of reserves, which has increased, actually. But
taking universities and local councils out of it and looking at those that you obviously have more direct control over, I mean, what are we talking, tens, hundreds of millions?
Do we have I can certainly write to the committee with that. I mean, there will be such huge differences between the level of reserves. So, obviously Creative Scotland's reserves have been pretty well discussed in the public domain. There'll be others that, have perhaps had less kind of scrutiny around the reserves. And I guess the point I would make is that we shouldn't necessarily see it as a negative. It might be very pertinent to investment plans and the reforms that they're going to be undertaking, but we can't ignore it either. It has to be part of the picture of how we get through to a more sustainable position with some of the reforms that need to be made and how reserves are utilised in the kind of short, medium term as well.
Thank you.
Okay.
Can I say we're actually expecting details of that in the next week or so? These are the amounts that have been discussed here. It's been a bit of a marathon session, actually. I want to thank colleagues and particularly yourself, Deputy First Minister, for your input. I'm just going to ask two or three very quick questions. One is when we can expect the updated infrastructure investment plan.
So we will give an update on the capital delivery of the existing infrastructure at the end of January, and then the infrastructure investment plan will be in the spring. Align once we know what the spring budget is delivering, which could end up impacting positively or negatively on capital. So it's, I think, important to see what that looks like before we bring forward the IIP revisions.
Okay, thank you. Now, this committee recommended that the Scottish Government produce a full response to the Scottish Fiscal Commission's Fiscal Sustainability Report, setting out the actions it will take to start addressing the longer-term challenges ahead. We haven't yet received that, so again, when can we expect that?
Again, I would say after the spring budget, I'm happy to furnish the committee with that longer-term plan.
Thank you.
And MTFS, obviously, in May is going to be a key point at which I can set out, in the light of what we know at that point, what that kind of medium term looks like. I think the point you're looking at goes a bit beyond that into the longer term, and I know that's something the committee's taking an interest in, so I will try to furnish the committee with as much info at the earliest opportunity.
Okay, and finally, with regard to non-domestic rates, £685 million of reliefs are in this budget. I certainly appreciate, as do Island Hospitality Businesses, £110,000 limit. which has been set on rates. I think that's been extremely helpful. At none will pay rates up to £110,000 a year. But I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government has been given the kind of discussions we've had earlier on, if the Scottish Government has done any work looking at the economic impact of reliefs, positive, relative to the sector, for example. We've had obviously a lot of people lobbying us on that particular issue. So I just want to know, not necessarily now, but whether or not the Scottish Government are looking to see how effective those reliefs are in terms of the sustainability of businesses and the growth of businesses and the overall economic impact.
Yeah, and that information and evidence will be important for the interventions that we're making. Obviously, reliefs change over time, so some cease and then new ones are introduced, and gathering an evidence base around the impact of each is important, and that work is ongoing. Happy to keep the committee appraised of information that we get back and the analysis of that.
So thank you very much. I realise how exhausting it must be to have to answer questions for 2.5 hours. I'm now going to call a break for 1 minute, and then we'll have 2 minutes in our private work session only, because I realise we're well over time. OK, thank you.